Rumpole and the Bubble Reputation, Rumpole meets Erskine Brown in Pomeroy's. Erskine Brown is depressed because he's doing a sordid ABH and a fray which allegedly occurred in a Soho nightclub. Rumpole tells him to visit the scene of the crime to get the lay of the land, which they do. They drink with Maurice Machen, the editor of the Daily Beacon, who tells Rumpole that an article in his paper by one Stella January alleged that Amela Nettleship, an author of historical novels, has affairs with married men. She is suing the paper and Maurice Machen for libel. Will Rumpole defend? He agrees.
Rumpole and the Bubble Reputation by John Mortimer. Adapted by Richard Stoneman.
Unlike my wife Hilda, you may be fortunate enough never to have read an historical novel by the overrated authoress Miss Amelia Nettleship. Her books contain virginal heroines and courageous heroes, and thus present an extremely misleading account of our rough island story.
Ooh.
What?
In 1965, Miss Nettleship was frequently photographed wearing cotton print dresses with large spectacles on her pretty little nose, feeding her cats in a wisteria-clad Tudor cottage on the outskirts of Godalming.
I don't believe it.
Oh, for God's sake.
In the interviews she gave, Miss Nettleship referred to the evils of the permissive society and the dreadful consequences of sex before marriage.
No. Oh, no.
Alas, for a while, she shared my bed. Not in person, but in book form, propped up on the bosom of she who must be obeyed.
Do you have a cold coming on, Hilda?
No, Rumpole. Touching.
Oh. Sorry.
Not you. This book is touching. Very touching. I thought Lord Stingo was a bit of a rake, but he's turned out quite differently.
Huh? What a sad disappointment.
Nonsense. It's ending very happily. He swore he'd never marry, but Lady Sophia has made him swallow his words.
Oh, if they were written by Amelia Nettleship, I'm sure he found them indigestible. Any chance of turning out the light? I need some sleep. Sleep at its own world, and a wild realm of wild reality. And dreams in their development have breath and tears.
And so, after a mere 5 or 6 hours of shut-eye, I struggled through the following day until my blood alcohol concentration slipped to a dangerously low level.
Teach us, sprite or bird, what sweet thoughts are thine. I have never heard praise of love or wine that panted forth a flood of rapture so divine.
As I left chambers that evening, I faced the age-old dilemma.
Chorus hymeneal or triumphant chant matched with thine would be all but an empty vaunt, a thing wherein we feel there is some hidden want.
Should I hurry home to she who must be obeyed, and to our young son Nicholas?
What objects are the fountains of thy happy strain? What fields or waves or mountains? What shapes of sky or plain? What love of thine own kind? What ignorance of pain?
Or take a moment to review the strengths and weaknesses of the case against my client and thereby strive to become a more effective advocate. I hurried to Pomeroy's wine bar, where I spied my learned colleague, Claude Erskine Brown, alone and palely loitering.
Erskine Brown, what can ail you?
Oh, Rumpole, it's my practice.
Still practicing? I thought you might have got the hang of it by now.
Oh, yes, yes, amusing. I used to do a decent class of work, but it's come to this. Yeah. Actual bodily harm and affray at the Kitten Argogo, Soho.
Ah, yes. I know it well.
Yes, two unsavoury characters in leather jackets dueling with broken bottles of Coca-Cola.
Sounds like my line of country.
Exactly. I'm scraping the bottom of your barrel.
Thank you.
I'll have to ask for some tips. For instance, what on earth am I supposed to do?
To begin with, visit the locus in quo. Go to the scene of the crime. Inspect the geography of the place.
The geography of the kitten agogo? Do I really have to?
Of course. Then during the trial, you can suggest it was too dark to identify anyone, or the witness couldn't see around a pillar, or...
It's you, isn't it? I wasn't sure, but now I'm looking at you close up, I'm pretty sure I'm right. It is Horace Rumpole.
I think so, yes. Mr...
Machin. Maurice Machin. Editor of the Daily Beacon. We met a long time ago when you were defending a wife-beater in Bromley. You got him off.
So he wasn't a wife-beater.
Oh, we both knew he was guilty as charged. But you were very clever, Mr. Rumpole. And I have to confess, I was mightily impressed.
Thank you, Mr. Machin.
You can call me Maury.
Gosh, can I really?
And you can help me out, professionally speaking, with a little spot of bother I'm in. My reputation's been impugned, and I seem to be charged with libel.
Rumpole never does libel.
Rumpole never turns down any kind of case, especially if a reputation's at stake.
So you think a reputation's important?
Good name in a man or woman, dear my lord, is the immediate jewel of their souls. Who steals my purse steals trash. Tis something, nothing. Twas mine, tis his, and has been slave to thousands. But he that filches from me my good name robs me of that which not enriches him and makes me poor indeed.
Is that one of your speeches, Mr. Rumpole?
Shakespeare, actually.
Of course.
Your good name, Mr. Machin, is something I shall be prepared to defend to the death. And, of course, the good name of your newspaper.
Our paper does go in for a certain amount of fearless exposure.
Yes. The exposure on page 3 every day. The Beacon Beauties. They're very popular in the clerk's room.
I'm not talking about that kind of exposure. I'm talking about telling the truth about people in the public eye. We're not a cheap, sordid little scandal sheet, Mr. Rumpole.
Perish the thought.
So, would you be happy to act on my behalf?
A barrister is an old taxi plying for hire. That's the fine tradition of our trade. It's my sacred duty, Mr. Machin, to take on anyone who's in trouble, however repellent I may happen to find them.
Thank you. Thank you.
Think nothing of it. Now, what exactly is the little spot of bother you say you're in? Give me details.
Well, as a newspaper, we're dedicated to exposing hypocrisy in our society, wherever it exists, high or low. So, when we find this female pretending to be a force for purity and parading her morality before the great British public, denouncing premarital sex, even if it's just the normal stuff, well, we feel it's our duty to tell our readers that this self-same female does not practice what she preaches. And so, I commissioned this little piece that ran a couple of months ago.
May I see?
It's not your case, Erskine Brown.
Oh, we both know it should be, Rumpole. The Private Life of Amelia Nettleship.
Really? Not the Amelia Nettleship? The expert bottler of pure historical bilge water?
The novelist and hypocrite.
She robs me of my sleep. I know nothing of her morality, but her prose style depraves and corrupts the English language. Who wrote the article?
Miss Stella January.
Oh, she left the paper last week.
And went where?
Not sure. Manchester, I think, to work on The Guardian.
We have to find her.
Really?
If we're going to fight this, which we are, I shall need to speak to Miss January. And then I shall conquer. I never plead guilty.
There speaks a man who knows damn all about libel. You haven't even read the offending article yet.
Oh, just give me a précis.
Amelia Nettleship, two-faced charlatan, girls in her novels always keep their legs crossed until they've got a ring on their finger. Her own private life rather different, torrid past. Makes Mae West sound like Florence Nightingale. Home near Godalming, scene of numerous sordid liaison. Married men leaving in the wee small hours. Oh, it goes on and on.
Much like Amelia Nettleship.
I have a meeting later with the barrister who's representing the proprietor of the Beacon. The Sheridan Club. 8 o'clock. Can you join us, Mr. Rumpole?
Of course. Who's the barrister?
Robin Pepiat, QC.
Porky Pepiat? We were at Winchester together.
I believe he's rather good. And rather expensive.
Quite a contrast to Rumpole. On both counts.
Why don't I take that newspaper cutting, Erskine Brown? And why don't we pop down the kit in a go-go so you can prepare for your nasty little affray?
Must we?
Oh, I think we must. Say what you like about Erskine Brown, and I frequently do. He does take advice. And so we found ourselves in a dark cul-de-sac just off Wardour Street, where every doorway had a young woman with a beckoning finger and an obscenely short skirt to entice the passing trade into the basement cabins beneath their high-heeled shoes.
Here we are.
Oh no, Rumpole, I really don't think I can. What would Phyllida say if she could see me now? Oh,
I'm sure she deplored your professional commitment.
She wouldn't think I was some kind of dirty old man.
I doubt she'd think of you as old, Erskine Brown. Dirty, yes. Now, careful going down the stairs.
I do.
It was, in fact, difficult to imagine what Miss Phyllida Trant would have thought of the two of us as we took our places at a small table in front of the tiny stage. I hadn't seen the Portia of our chambers for nearly 3 months. She was weeks away from giving birth and only days away from getting married. Her fiancé looked flustered.
My God, Rumpel, that woman's virtually naked. And she's coming this way. No, don't look, don't look.
Evening, gents. Can I get you some drinks and some company?
No, thank you. We're here for purely observational duties.
You are?
We intend to look and learn, nothing more.
Well, no one's allowed to do any touching, if that was you was hoping for. I'll fetch some champagne,
no,
shall
no, that
I?
Won't be... Oh, damn. She'll bring a bottle of fizzy cider and charge us 3 guineas. I'll try and stop her.
Don't leave me, Rumpel. Good Lord. What on earth is she wearing? Or rather, not wearing.
This way, Gav. Smile.
What?
I think I've cleared up the matter, though you will have to drink this glass of whiskey, I'm afraid.
What about you?
Oh, I have my con in the Sheridan Club. I'm sure you'll be fine on your own.
Someone just took my picture, Rumpel.
Really? Well, perhaps they'll try to sell you a copy of the photograph before you leave. If I were you, I'd decline the offer. Oh, look, I think the artiste is coming to join you.
Oh, no! No, please, stay back. Please!
As Erskine Brown enjoyed the attentions of Miss Fifi Bojangles and the semi-conscious snake she wore around her neck, I joined the editor of the Daily Beacon and Robin Pepiat QC in the Sheridan Club, where champagne really was champagne, and the waiters kept their tops on.
Well, we should work as a team, old chap. And as leading counsel, I suppose I'm the captain.
Are we playing cricket, old chap?
If it were, it would be an extremely expensive game for the Beacon. The proprietors have contracted to indemnify the editor against any libel damages, no matter how high.
Yeah, I insisted on that when I took the job.
That was very sensible of your client, Rumpel.
Was it really?
Oh, yes. And don't worry, I realise you're not used to this type of case. You are, after all, one of the criminal boys.
Just a juvenile delinquent compared to you, old chap.
Quite. And it's obvious to me we mustn't attempt to justify these serious charges against Miss Nettleship's honour.
Why not? Wouldn't that be cricket?
If we try to prove she's some kind of amateur tot, the jury might bump the damages up to £6,000 or £7,000.
But you filed a defence alleging the article's a true bill.
But that's just our bargaining counter. Something to give away as part of the deal. When we agree terms with the other side, we'll abandon all our allegations gracefully.
We put up our hands?
Well, yes. You mustn't worry about the details. Peregrine Lancy is a Guinness, and I'm lunching with Perry tomorrow. I'll just whisper the thought of a quiet little settlement into his ear, and that'll be that.
Whisper sweet nothings? I'll not be party to any settlement.
Quite right.
No, I will defend the good name of my client, Mr. Maurice Machin, as a responsible editor.
At our expense?
If necessary, yes. He wouldn't have published that story unless there was some truth in it, would you, Mr. Machin?
Certainly not.
That's all well and good, old chap. But there's absolutely no evidence that Miss Nettleship has behaved as described in the article.
No evidence? Then we must find some, old chap. I'm quite unable to believe that anyone who writes so badly has no other vices. A few days later, I entered the clerk's room of our chambers in Equity Court to see our chief clerk, Henry, sitting at his desk, perusing a copy of the Daily Beacon.
Good morning, Henry.
Oh, good morning, sir. Didn't hear you come in.
Oh, please don't stop reading. I'm sure that fine crusading paper has exposed yet more hypocrisy.
You might be right, sir. And talking of the Beacon, I've got your brief for the Nettleship case. You'll be pleased to hear we've agreed a nice fee plus refreshers of 10 guineas. So you can make it last a while, can't you?
At 10 guineas per day, I'll stretch it out till the trump of doom.
Morning, Henry.
Yet, oh, morning, Rumpel.
How goes your sordid affray?
Still sordid. Much like this rag, which I feel should be banned from chambers.
Now, I wouldn't look in there.
There's the Beacon Beauty today. Someone with an IQ slightly smaller than a... Oh, my God.
What's wrong, Erskine Brown? Someone you know?
I did try to stop you, sir.
It's me.
You're the Beacon Beauty?
No, no. Some kind of story under a photograph of me. Spotted in the Kitten Agogo. Junior barrister.
Oh.
Claude Erskine Brown, gawping at the steamy strippers. I wasn't gawping. I was researching. You told me to go there. The locus in quo. This is all your fault, Rumpo.
Clark's room?
At least I spelled your name correctly.
Yeah, now,
and you're not actually looking directly at Fifi Bojangles.
Away,
or her snake.
Head of Chambers would like to see you, sir.
Me? Ballard wants to see me?
Quite urgently, sir.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Oh, God. Oh, God.
But he didn't sack you, so what's the problem?
What's the problem? For one thing, Ballard wants me to sue the Daily Beacon to protect the reputation of Number 3 Equity Court, which will cost me a small fortune. Worse than that, far worse than that, what will Phyllida say when she sees the photograph?
Why would she see it? You don't have the Beacon delivered to your place in Islington, do you?
The milkman will show it to her. I think he hates me for some reason, and I'm sure he reads that despicable scandal sheet. Oh, yes. Philly will see me, gawping.
Well, she's not going to call off the wedding. Not for something as trivial as this nonsense.
She might.
Well, in which case you won't need me as best man.
Well, don't you want to be best man? Don't you want to support me, stand shoulder to shoulder, side by side?
Normally I'd love to, Erskine Brown, but I do have my own reputation to protect.
What?
I'm joking, of course. I'm sure the wedding would go ahead as planned.
I hope you're right.
Good evening, Mr. Bumpo.
Fig! How lovely to see you. Erskine Brown, have you ever made the acquaintance of Mr. Ferdinand Isaac Gerald Newton?
No.
The best private eye in town.
Not a lot of competition, Mr. Rumbo.
Even so. Come to the bar. Let me buy you a drink. And I'll tell you what I need you to find for me.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
Mr. Erskine Brown, I got your message.
You've got some nerve coming here, Machin.
But you asked me to come here.
Oh, yes. Yes, I did. Because I'm furious. How could you print those lies about me?
What lies? You were in the Kitten Agogo. You were watching a stripper perform on stage.
Only because I got involved in a violent affray with actual bodily harm.
You had a fight in a club?
No, 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 no. I wasn't fighting. I'm defending an affray that occurred in the Kitten Agogo. I was merely looking at the scene of the crime. But your wretched paper didn't mention any of that.
How do I know it's true?
Just ask Rumpole. He'll confirm my story.
Yeah. But you lot all stick together, don't you?
I insist you print an apology. You have to explain to your readers that I'm not the kind of man they think I am.
If we print an apology, it makes it look like we got it wrong.
You did get it wrong!
Only according to you. But I think our story stands up. So, good night, Mr. Erskine Brown.
Come back here, Machin! I demand you tell the world! I demand you tell them! Watching naked women does not make me a pervert! Oh, God.
By the time I returned to Erskine Brown's table, the odious Mr. Machin had left the building. Fig Newton set off to Godalming to stake out Amelia Nettleship's cottage, and I pushed off home for a fitful night with the book-loving Hilda. Returning to Chambers in the morning, a surprise awaited me in the gentleman's lavatory. Erskine Brown, you're shaving.
Yeah, Rumpole, you're early.
Did you sleep in Chambers last night?
Well, I wasn't allowed to stay at home. As predicted, Philippa was shown that wretched newspaper.
By the milkman?
And the postman, and the greengrocer. She banished me from my own house.
Cancelled the wedding?
Not yet. If I sue the Beacon for libel, there's a chance she'll forgive me. But then we won't have any money with which to bring up our newborn child. And it's all thanks to you, Rumpole.
I really don't think you should continue to blame me.
I beg to differ. Of course, I won't be able to spend another night here in Chambers. The cleaners will report me to Ballard.
Yes, it's a risky old business, as I learned for myself.
Yes, I seem to remember when you fell out with Hilda. You planted yourself with me. My kitchen still bears the scorch marks from your fry-ups.
Ah, no. I was indeed grateful for your hospitality.
And what's the journey like from Gloucester Road to here, Rumpole?
My front door is always open, Claude, and I'd be delighted to put you...
Oh, thank you.
But I could never ask you to shoulder the burden of daily life with she who must be obeyed. It simply wouldn't be fair on you. I thought I'd done enough to dissuade my learned friend from seeking hospitality under the Rumpole roof, and so, with a glad heart, I went about my daily business. When my work was done, I decided to share some of the good fortune brought with my libel brief. I splashed out on 2 bottles of Pomeroy's Bubbly and some of the least exhausted flowers to be found outside Temple Tube Station.
Is that you, Rumpole?
No, Hilda. It's Judge Bullingham. I was hoping for a game of tiddlywinks with your husband.
What on earth have you got there?
All the fruits of the earth. Or, let's say, the fruits of the first cheque in Nettleship v. the Beacon, paid in advance. The first of many, if we can spin out the proceedings.
You're doing that awful case.
That awful case will bring us 10 guineas a day in refreshers.
Helping that squalid newspaper insult Amelia Nettleship.
A barrister's duty, Hilda, is to take on all comers, however squalid.
Nonsense.
What?
Nonsense. You're only using that as an excuse. In actual fact, you're jealous of Amelia Nettleship.
My life has been full of longings, but I've never had the slightest desire to become a female novelist, if that's what you can call the illiterate lady.
My mind is made up, Rumpole. I won't take a drop of that champagne, and those flowers can go straight in the dustbin, which is where it appears you found them.
Now, Hilda, you listen to me. Oh, God. That's not... Please tell me that's not...
Claude telephoned and told me all his troubles with Philomena Trump.
Philida Trant.
And, of course, I invited him to stay.
Good evening, Rumpole.
You're wearing my dressing gown.
Yeah, I had to pack in a hurry. Ooh, champagne. To welcome me into your lovely home.
No.
Was the bath all right, Claude?
Absolutely lovely. Though I fear I've used up all the hot water.
The geezer can be quite temperamental. But Rumpole can do without his bath tonight. Let's go through.
Yeah. Now, which is your chair in here, Rumpole?
I sit next to the gas fire.
Not this evening. We mustn't let you get cold after your bath, Claude. So you go over there, and Rumpole will open the champagne, won't you, Rumpole?
As you command, Hilda. It was the Wagner belting out of the wireless over breakfast that drove me from my own kitchen the next morning. I sought sanctuary in the Royal Courts of Justice, where, when wigged and robed, I met Maurice Machin and Robin Pepiat QC.
Miss Nettleship is digging her heels in, refusing all offers of a settlement.
Good.
It is not good, Mr. Machin. I was hoping to wrap this up before luncheon at the Sheridan. It's steak and kidney pud on Thursdays.
My client's reputation is a little more important than steak and kidney pud. You're asking him to sign a statement admitting he printed lies.
If he joins in the apology, the Beacon will pay the costs and damages.
Who steals my purse steals trash, but he that filches from me my good name...
Oh, for heaven's sake, they gave up quoting that in libel actions 50 years ago.
Mr. Rumpole's right, though. My good name is the immediate jewel of my soul.
Steady on, old darling. Let's not go too far.
Unless we settle now, this case could last a couple of weeks.
A couple of weeks? How very... expensive.
I tried to keep the smile from my lips as I entered the court. At 10 guineas a day, I was overjoyed at Miss Nettleship's refusal to settle for anything less than a drawn-out fight in front of a jury. And Mr. Justice Teasdale...
Rattling good yarns!
...who, it seemed, was a fan of the plaintiff.
Take it from me, members of the jury, her novels are what you might call page-turners.
My lord...
Yes, Mr. Rumbold?
Rumpole, my lord.
I'm so sorry. I fear you're something of a stranger to these courts.
Would it not be better to allow the jury to come to their own conclusions about Miss Amelia Nettleship and the quality of her writing?
Well, yes, of course. And when they do come to their own conclusions, they'll find she can put together a rattling good yarn.
All I could do was subside and look balefully at the judge. I felt a pang of nostalgia for the Old Bailey. The morning wore on, and it wasn't until mid-afternoon that I got my first chance to confront the authoress.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
If ever I saw a composed and confident witness, that witness was Amelia Nettleship. Her hair was perfectly done. Her black suit was perfectly discreet. Her white blouse shone, as did her spectacles. So spotless did she seem that she might well have preserved her virginity until that very day. When she finished her evidence in chief, the thankless task of attacking her fair name was left to me.
Are you a truthful woman?
I try to be.
And you call yourself an historical novelist?
I attempt to write books which uphold certain standards of morality.
Forget the morality for a moment. Let's concentrate on the history. May I read you a short passage from an alleged historical novel of yours entitled Lord Stingo's Fancy?
Ah, yes, yes. Isn't that the one that ends happily?
Happily all her books end, my lord, eventually. To quote from this particular yarn, Sophia had first set eyes on Lord Stingo when she was a dewy 18-year-old and he had clattered up to her father's castle exhausted from the Battle of Naseby.
Since I'd yet to hear a word from Fig Newton, I was forced to spend as much time as possible analysing Amelia's creative efforts.
Now at the ball to triumphantly celebrate the gorgeous enthroning coronation of the merry monarch King Charles II, they were to meet again. Sophia was now in her 20s, but in ways too numerous to completely describe, still an unspoilt girl at heart. You call that an historical novel?
Certainly.
Haven't you forgotten something?
I don't think so. What?
Oliver Cromwell.
I really don't know what you mean.
Clearly, if this Sophia, this girl...
Dewy girl, Mr. Rumbold.
If this dew-bespattered Sophia had been 18 at the time of the Battle of Naseby in the reign of Charles I, she would have been 33 in the year of Charles II's coronation, and Oliver Cromwell came in between them.
I am an artist, Mr. Rumbold.
It's Rumpole. And what kind of an artist are you, exactly?
I think Miss Nettleship means she's an artist in words.
Oh, really? Then she must have noticed that the short passage I read to the jury contained two split infinitives and a tautology.
What?
It means using two words that mean the same thing, my lord, as in the enthroning coronation. It's spelt T-A-U...
I'm aware of its meaning, and I know how to spell.
Well, then your lordship has the advantage of the plaintiff, who spells Naseby with a Z.
Perhaps this sort of cross-examination is common in the criminal courts, but I cannot see how it can possibly be relevant in an action for libel.
These questions, my lord, go to the heart of this lady's credibility.
I was running out of steam.
I have to suggest, Miss Nettleship, that as an historical novelist, you are a complete fake.
But
still no sign of Fig Newton.
You have no respect for history and very little respect for the English language.
So I was forced to take avoiding action.
My lord, I have questions, many questions, about the article that appeared in the Daily Beacon and its veracity. However, I see Miss Nettleship is looking tired.
I'm absolutely fine.
And I think it unfair on her and on the jury to begin a new line of inquiry when everyone's feeling exhausted.
It's only 3:30, Mr. Brumbold.
Which your lordship might feel is a little late in the day to start asking questions concerning Miss Nettleship's attitude towards sex before marriage, previous boyfriends, and the allegations by Stella January of liaisons with married men. If your lordship feels Miss Nettleship should get a good night's sleep before the arduous task of answering a barrage of personal and intrusive inquiries, I would have no objection.
Very well. We'll continue tomorrow morning. 10:30?
All rise!
I breathed a sigh of relief, then hurried to Pomeroy's, not merely to avoid an early return to the mansion flat in which Erskine Brown would be playing his way through Die Meistersinger, but also to meet Fig Newton and find out what dirt, if any, he could dish on Amelia Nettleship.
I stayed outside her cottage all night, Mr. Rumpole. I seen a bloke going in just after midnight, and then he come out again this morning, round about 5:30.
Why didn't you tell me? I was on my feet with nothing to say.
I was trying to find Stella January. I thought that was more important.
And?
She doesn't exist.
What do you mean?
I've never come across anyone I can't locate. But unless Miss January's a lot smarter than me, which is unlikely, I'll bet my bungalow on there being no such person.
You're quite sure?
I talked to a few people at the Beacon, off the record sort of thing, and no one ever saw her there. She's never written nothing for any other paper.
Hmm. And the bloke who stayed the night with Amelia, do you have a name for him?
Afraid not.
Oh.
And before you ask, I never saw his face because it was dark.
Did he have a car?
Yep.
You got the number?
No.
Oh, Fig.
But I did get this, Mr. Rumble.
A copy of the Beacon? How does this help me?
It was dropped by the bloke when he was getting out of his car last night. See the front page?
Oh, yes. Yes. I think that's interesting, Fig. Very interesting. The next day's edition of the Daily Beacon was coming hot off the press when I arrived at their building in Fleet Street. I glanced at the headline, something about a popular music performer and his latest dalliance with illegal narcotics. Up on the third floor, a couple of crumpled old hacks were drinking whiskey at their desks, proud of their efforts to expose hypocrisy and corruption, exhausted by their attempts to find salacious gossip worth printing.
No. No, we couldn't grab a photo in the ambulance. If she did, we'll try to get a snap of the body in the mortuary. But I can't promise. I have to go now, sir. Something's come up.
I'm sorry, Maury. I didn't mean to interrupt.
It was a proprietor. He rings every night.
Checking up on your stories? Trying to guess if your circulation will continue to plummet? Perhaps a final warning before he fires you.
What do you want?
I've just been with a friend who's spoken to some of your colleagues. In strict confidence, they told him your job's on the line.
That's not true.
So sue me. My friend also told me something interesting about Miss Stella January.
Oh?
You are Stella January.
Your friend sounds like he's off his head.
Actually, he merely said she doesn't exist. I'm the one who thinks she's you.
And why would you think that?
Because you wrote the article about Amelia Nettleship, knowing it would get the paper into trouble, knowing that Amelia would take you to court.
I'd have to be a masochist to want something like that to happen.
Well, it won't be you paying costs and damages. It'll be the proprietor. And he's about to lose a fortune.
We've still got a chance of winning the case.
Oh, no, we haven't. We'll fight for days and days, but in the end, the jury will award a huge amount of money to your girlfriend.
To my what?
You were seen entering and leaving Amelia's cottage last night. You arrived at midnight, left this morning before dawn.
Says who?
Says the man who picked up your litter from the drive. The Daily Beacon.
yesterday's copy.
Anyone in Godalming could have bought this.
No. On the front page just there, it says first edition. That usually hits your desk at what time? 10 p.m, 10:30? I imagine you gave it the once-over, then hurried off for your midnight tryst in Surrey.
You're clutching at straws. You got no real proof it was me that wrote the piece.
I agree, there's an element of guesswork.
Huh?
I'm guessing, for instance, that no young female journalist, such as Stella January, would make a comparison between Mae West and Florence Nightingale. But you would, and you did. And with a little more digging, I'm quite sure my friend will find concrete evidence to back up these theories of mine.
I did go and see Amelia last night, but only to ask her to drop the case.
Well, to use a legal expression, pull the other one. It's got bells on it. I told you I'm a taxi waiting on the rank, but I'm not prepared to be the getaway driver for a crime like this.
Have you told anyone about your theories?
Not yet.
And you won't, will ya? Because you're my lawyer.
Not any longer, Mr. Machin. I'm now an ordinary citizen about to report an attempted crime. I don't think there's any limit on the sentence for conspiracy to pervert the course of justice.
What do you mean? Conspiracy?
You're about to be sacked by the Beacon. Maybe they're paying you off, but not with enough dosh for your liking. So your girlfriend and you get together to make £6,000 or £7,000.
I wish I knew how.
Perfectly simple. You turn yourself into Stella January, the unknown girl reporter, and libel Amelia, your girlfriend. She sues the paper and collects the money. Then you both sail into the sunset and share the proceeds. But there's one thing I can't forgive. You're probably wondering what that is. Oh, all right, I'll tell you. Your plan called for an Old Bailey hack, a stranger to the civilized world of libel who wouldn't settle, someone who'd attack the nettleship and inflame the damages. So you used me, Mr. Machin. You used me. Since it's a libel action, I'll offer you terms of settlement.
What sort of terms?
The fair Amelia to drop her case, you pay the costs, and in the matter of my learned friend Claude Erskine Brown...
Huh? What's he got to do with this?
Print a full and grovelling apology on the front page of the Beacon and get them to pay a substantial sum by way of damages. Why did you print that photograph in the first place?
It was supposed to be a picture of you. I heard you say you were going to that club, and I wanted a bargaining tool. Just in case everything fell apart.
But when you didn't get a picture of me?
Our readers enjoy seeing people like Erskine Brown in places they shouldn't be. The pompous git deserved it.
And now you deserve everything you're going to get, which from the Daily Beacon is nothing at all. Good night, Stella. I'll see myself out.
The front-page apology was enough to convince the Portia of our chambers to forgive her fiancé and turn up for their wedding just a few days later. She, who must be obeyed, refused to attend, citing her opposition to premarital sex as the reason. As best man, I was duty-bound to show my face.
You have the ring, Rumpel?
Unless it's jumped out of my pocket in the 2 minutes since you last asked me, yes.
And you've organised some taxis to take us to the reception?
I thought we'd all go by bus.
What?
The number 11 goes door to door and they run pretty frequently.
Rumpel, I don't want to go... Oh, you're having a joke at my expense.
It's so hard not to, Erskine Brown. Look, here comes the bride. Bad luck to see her before the ceremony.
Well, we spent last night together. We had breakfast.
Just do as you're told and go inside.
Oh, very well. But don't delay. The next wedding's in 20 minutes.
Good afternoon, Mr. Rumpole.
Good afternoon, Miss Trant. You look...
enormous.
I was going to say... actually, enormous will do.
It's kind of you to help Claude. And I know you arranged for that apology in the paper. Though I'm not quite sure how you managed it.
Best you don't know the details.
Mrs. Rumpole isn't here.
I'm afraid she doesn't approve.
Of me.
Of just about everything.
Well, it was good of her to put up with Claude whilst we had our little misunderstanding.
Good of me, too.
How did your libel end?
With a sudden outburst of peace and goodwill, much to the fury of Mr. Justice Teasdale.
You settled out of court?
Hmm. Amelia Nettleship dropped all the allegations and the Beacon paid the costs with extremely bad grace. I've asked Henry to find me a nice bit of burglary or a GBH... anything which shows human nature in a better light than civil law.
I don't think you'll ever change, Mr. Rumpole.
I fear you're about to, Mrs. Erskine Brown to be. And so, after a short ceremony in front of half a dozen friends, but strangely no members of either the Erskine Brown or the Trant families, we travelled by taxi to the Goring Hotel in Victoria. And the moment I'd been dreading was soon upon us.
Ladies and gentlemen. thank you. It's customary, as you know, for the best man to make a speech, and being accustomed to rising to my feet and droning on for hours on subjects about which I know very little, I
found myself lost for words.
Well, I should say something about Erskine Brown and his beautiful bride.
I racked my brains for some words of wisdom. Yeah. Byron, Wordsworth, could Shakespeare help me?
Was it not a Roman acquaintance of Coriolanus who said, the fittest time to corrupt a man's wife is when she's fallen out with her husband?
Why did I think of that particular quotation? I quickly moved on to a sonnet.
Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediments. Love is not love which alters when it alteration finds, or bends with the remover to remove.
Mr. Rumpole.
I realised the Portia of our chambers was looking up at me.
In Belmont is a lady richly left, and she is fair, and fairer than that word, of wondrous virtues.
I tried not to gaze back at Portia.
Oh, no. It is an ever-fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. It is the star to every wandering bark, whose worth's unknown, although his height be taken. Love's not time's fool, though rosy lips and cheeks.
I couldn't continue. So I turned in desperation to Lord Byron.
Lord Byron said, friendship may and often does grow into love, but love never subsides into friendship.
With a final glance at the beautiful ex-Miss Trant and a final effort to put romantic thoughts from my mind once and for all, I brought my sorry speech to an abrupt conclusion.
More to the point, Byron also said, man being reasonable must get drunk. The best of life is but intoxication. So, please raise your glasses and toast the bride and groom. Claude and Portia. Philida. Claude and Philida. Erskine Brown.
Claude and Philida.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you.
We look before and after and pine for what is not. Our sincerest laughter with some pain is fraught. Our sweetest songs are those that tell of saddest thought. Yet if we could scorn hate and pride and fear, if we were things born not to shed a tear, I know not how thy joy we ever should come near. Better than all measures of delightful sound, better than all treasures that in books are found, thy skill to poet were, thou scorner of the ground.
In Rumpole and the Bubble Reputation by John Mortimer, Horace Rumpole was Benedict Cumberbatch, Hilda Rumpole, Jasmine Hyde, Phillida Erskine Brown, Cathy Sarah, Claude Erskine Brown, Nigel Anthony, Maurice Machin, Ewan Bailey, and Porky Pepiat, Stephen Critchlow. Other parts were played by members of the company. Rumpole and the Bubble Reputation was adapted by Richard Stoneman, directed by Marilyn Imrie, and is a Catherine Bailey production for BBC Radio 4.
Set during the London Blitz of 1940, Murder on the Home Front is a vibrant, original crime drama. This is a world where people live life in the moment. It is also a world where criminals can use the blackout and devastation to hide their darkest activities. As the Luftwaffe drop their bombs, below people are literally getting away with murder. Dr. Lennox Collins is a pathologist new to murder cases, obsessed with pursuing the truth through all means available. Molly Cooper is not only the first secretary to a pathologist, she is the first woman allowed into a very male world. All Lennox knows is that she has a strong stomach, 60 words a minute, and a keen brain.
Murder on the Home Front, Episode 1. Love at First Sight by Michael Crompton. Inspired by Molly Le Fubieu's book of the same name. Spring, 1941.
Fantastic dancer. I was born with two left feet.
That's what you do, as long as you keep moving.
Everybody, stay where you are.
Oh. No, not again.
I said, stay where you are.
What's going on?
I was really enjoying myself.
What's happening?
Oh, the police. They raid this place at least once a week.
Are we going to get arrested?
Why? Are you worried about something?
No. It's just that I'm an officer.
Well, I can see that.
A night in jail won't go down too well with Colonel Phillips.
Don't worry. We'll be fine.
You would all need to show some proof of identification.
I must get out of here.
Why? What's happened?
You must believe I've done nothing wrong. Well, nothing to hurt anyone or stolen anything. It's just that...
The sooner we get this done, the sooner we'll allow you all to leave.
Come on.
You know another way out?
Follow me.
Where to?
Head to the steps.
Where are we exactly?
Oh, this is the unofficial tradesman's entrance.
Are you sure the police don't cover the back?
You really are in trouble, aren't you?
Yes, I am. Thank you for helping me.
Quickly!
What's happened?
Oh, I don't know, but let's hang around. Oh, blast!
You all right?
Oh, my heel's broken. New on.
Oh. I'll carry you down.
Oh, no, I'll be...
One, two... Oh. Oh.
Are you all right?
Fine.
On my night in khaki uniform.
How will you walk?
Oh, I'll manage.
There we go.
Oh.
You down there.
Oh, quickly.
I don't even know your name.
What? Molly.
Molly, I'm George.
Hello, George. Come on. You don't want to get caught.
It's a pleasure, Molly. A real pleasure. Look, where exactly is this milk plug taking us?
Whitechapel.
You live in the East End.
What's wrong with the East End?
Nothing. It's just you don't sound as if you were born within the sound of Bow Bells.
With what I earn, I can't afford to live in Mayfair.
You work? You have a job?
My mother can't stand it. Originally, she refused to let me. But my father managed to persuade her. Do the girl some good, get a bit of life inside her. And he was right. I've learned more about the world in the last few months than in the entire 19 years I spent at home.
You're 19?
Did I say 19?
You seem much older.
Oh, I am. Much.
What do you do?
I'm a reporter for the East London Gazette.
Gosh.
Well, I'm only a junior reporter.
Only? It must be very exciting.
Yes, it can be. That's part of the reason I wanted the job. But at the moment, my editor is making sure I serve my apprenticeship. Starting to rain.
Here, please, come under my coat. Do you believe in love at first sight?
No, I don't. Not love.
What then?
Slow down, George, you're going too fast.
I know, sorry. It's something I do.
I hope you're not going to tell me that this could be your last night alive and you were hoping for some company because I've heard it all before.
I had a weekend pass and I've not gone back.
Absent without leave?
I went to the station and there was the train waiting to take me back and I just didn't climb aboard. And from that moment to this, it's been like seeing everything for the very first time. When I saw you at the Palais, I... No. Maybe you're right. It's not love, but it's definitely something. Do you ever think that you're going to die? What?
Oh, first it's love, now it's death.
Yes, sorry. But that's how it is, isn't it?
If the bullet's got your name on it, then there's nothing you can do.
I'm not frightened or resigned. I feel so alive.
I can see that.
Here you go, Molly.
Thanks, Alf.
Walk on.
Sorry about all this. I've never done this before, and seeing you dancing with you, talking... Thanks.
George, do you fancy some breakfast? Shh! But best not wake my landlady.
Right.
You don't think I invite everyone home for breakfast?
I think I might be the first.
Yes. Yes, you are.
May I kiss you, Molly?
Well, I think that would be very nice indeed.
Is that you, Molly?
Good morning, Mrs. B.
Who's that with you?
Oh, this is George. He was good enough to see me home.
There's a telegram for you.
A telegram?
On the table, there. Shall I open it for you?
No, thank you.
Would you rather I go?
No, no. Whatever it says, I've got to read it. Oh, my word.
Not someone dead, is it?
I'm in court today.
What have you done?
No, to work. It's from my editor. The normal court reporter, Mr. Parsons, has met with an accident. I must get changed.
What about breakfast?
Oh, some other time. Thanks. No, my shoes!
Can I see you again?
Yes.
Where? When?
Some sunny day, I shouldn't wonder.
Pardon me?
You can see yourself out, can you?
Yes, of course.
George!
I'm still here.
I do want to see you again.
Good, I'm pleased.
Tonight, at the Palais.
I hope it doesn't get raided again.
Oh, don't worry. As long as you're with me, you'll be safe.
What regiment are you?
Durham Light Infantry.
Long way from home, aren't you, soldier?
Yes. I suppose I am.
Best get walking, then.
How am I to print a newspaper if I have no paper?
Late. Sit down.
Is this because we dare to criticise the conditions of the local shelters? Have you been down any of them?
I only just got your telegram.
Out dancing all night, I suppose.
Shall I tell you something, mister? The shelter my wife had to go into a couple of nights ago had one small paraffin heater that didn't work, a shabby green canvas curtain that fell off its rail, and there was a stream running right through the middle of it. It's a bloody scandal.
Oh, is that the one in Mile End?
Oh, a war, is it? I wondered. I just thought I lived in a rough neighbourhood. What are you wearing?
How do you mean?
Those shoes.
These shoes were the only ones I could find.
You're not going to a wedding, you know.
Where am I going?
The Old Bailey, court number one.
Is it a murder?
Yes, it is.
Right.
A major in the guards. No, his brother's in the guards. Anyway, the major comes home, discovers his wife is having an affair.
And kills her.
The usual thing.
I read about it. I wonder what happened.
He bludgeoned her to death. Listen, are you going to be all right? Taking a chance on you, Molly. He's a war hero under a lot of pressure. This country needs men like him.
A man about to be convicted for murder?
It shouldn't be murder at all, but manslaughter.
What about his poor wife?
She should have been stronger. She should have remained loyal no matter what the temptations were.
You seem to have written it already, sir.
I will, if you can't. Don't get me wrong, Molly. I admire your concern for the facts and all the different and interesting angles a story might have. But this is front page, Molly. I want it clear and I want it simple.
You want the truth, sir?
People get enough truth just walking down the street of a morning. The truth that their lives can end like that. And the very painful truth that there's not enough paper to wipe my ass, let alone print a bloody newspaper.
Is anyone sitting here?
This is for the press only.
Oh, I am the press. East London Gazette.
Where's Parsons?
The bus he was travelling on fell down a bomb crater in Balham High Street.
And you are?
Molly.
Good to see you on one, please, Molly. Jack Busby, Della Record. This your first court case?
Is it that obvious?
Sharpened pencil, new notepad.
Is the courtroom always as packed as this?
Major Fenton is a distinguished war hero.
Is that him? In the dock?
Yes, Molly. That's him.
Oh, my God.
Have you not seen a murderer before?
He doesn't look like a murderer.
Well, they never do.
His eyes. Look at them.
Well, they're not always too close together, you know.
Oh, it's as though he's dead.
Yes. Guilt can do strange things to a man.
What are we waiting for? Major Fenton looks like he wants it over now.
Mr. Hardcastle is late again.
Who's Mr. Hardcastle?
You really are a green one. Hardcastle is the Home Office pathologist.
Oh, I thought that was Sir John Wilkinson.
We're tired. Couldn't take it anymore. Hardcastle is a new man. His evidence will be crucial.
Major Fenton has already confessed.
Well, a lot of men are coming home from the war and taking it out on their wives. It's reached almost epidemic proportions.
So the Major might be made an example of?
Yes, he might well.
I don't think he did it.
That's woman's intuition, is it?
What happens now?
They've got a shelter here at the Old Bailey. Perhaps you and I could sit together. I could teach you a few tricks of the trade.
And you, a married man?
Well, in this day and age, Molly, we have to take what opportunities we can, as they may never present themselves again.
I think I'd rather take my chances with a Luftwaffe. Major Fenton, aged 42, sat in court awaiting trial for the murder of his wife. But behind his eyes there lay another story of clear and simple, Molly.
Molly?
Oh, you made me jump.
What are you doing out here?
Struggling for the right words.
You should be down in one of the shelters.
What exactly are you doing?
I came to see you.
A bit dangerous, don't you think? Old Bailey? Police?
I couldn't wait till tonight.
Where on earth did you get that coat?
I needed something to cover my uniform.
It doesn't fit properly.
No. I can't go home, can I?
I would have thought your mother would have welcomed you home with open arms.
She'd be the first to ring the police.
You didn't plan this very well, did you?
I didn't plan this at all. Someone's coming.
Take my pad and pencil.
Why?
Good afternoon. Where is everyone?
Down the shelters.
Are you reporters?
Are you Mr. Hardcastle?
I sent word I'd be a few minutes late. I don't talk to reporters.
No, neither do I.
Pardon me?
Well, he doesn't talk to reporters. Perhaps you should go and wait over there somewhere.
Oh, right.
I'm a student. I'm in your field. Do you mind if I sit next to you?
Sit where you like.
Is that your report?
Hmm?
On the Fenton case?
No. These are the reports from yesterday. I should have completed this morning, but some workers dug up a couple of skeletons in a building in Shoreditch.
You must be busy.
Yes, very.
All those are just yesterday's.
I can get through anything from 10 to 35 bodies a day.
Day?
6, sometimes 7 days a week. It's not the post-mortems that take the time. It's these endless reports I have to write.
Have you no one to help you?
My daughter was down for a while, but it didn't work out.
At least the Fenton case is easy enough.
What makes you say that?
Oh, well, it's a classic, isn't it?
A classic of what?
A crime passionnel. Isn't that what they call it? Perhaps I'm wrong.
A crime passionnel implies some passion, a struggle at least.
She didn't put up a fight.
Here, look for yourself.
Are you sure it's all right?
Of course. None of this is classified.
She was hit on the back of the head.
With substantial force. The Major stated that he pushed his wife over and she cracked her skull on a small table, but as you can see from the fractures,
it must have been done with a very heavy, blunt object.
Which has yet to be found.
Molly, I think I should be going now.
Well, the court might re-adjourn at any time.
I doubt it.
What do you mean?
The court will be in no hurry to convict a war hero, no matter how guilty he appears to be.
If the Major confessed to the crime, why would he have disposed of the weapon?
He was in such a rage that he threw it away, or so he claims. But he can't remember where, and he can't remember when.
Are you working for the defense, or the prosecution?
I work for the truth, and nothing but the truth.
You don't think he did it, do you?
What I think is irrelevant.
But you're giving the vital evidence. That's why they were waiting for you.
Excuse me, Mr. Hardcastle. The trial has been adjourned until after lunch.
Thank you.
What are you going to do?
How do you mean?
Well, if you think Major Fenton is innocent...
Unless Major Fenton changes his plea, no matter what I think or say or show to the jury, he will be convicted of the murder of his wife. And he'll hang for it. Good day to you.
But...
Yes. Goodbye, Mr. Hardcastle.
Goodbye.
That overcoat you're wearing.
I know. It's the wrong size.
And it doesn't hide what you wanted to hide.
He knows I'm on the run.
No, he doesn't.
You heard him.
He knows you're hiding something, that's all.
Can we get out of here?
Yes. I need to get to Hampstead.
Why?
I want to go to the Fentons' house.
No.
I have to.
Whatever for?
Because Major Fenton is not guilty.
Then why has he confessed?
That's what I mean to find out.
It could be dangerous.
I know.
Then if you insist on going, I'll drive you there.
You have a car?
Yes. I know it's not a great idea, me driving about London, but I want to be with you.
Why didn't you drive us home last night?
I thought a milk float was so much more romantic.
I got soaked.
And I fell in love.
Please, George. Slow down.
I thought you wanted to get there.
One piece I do. You don't want the police to stop you, do you?
No, I don't.
George, they'll catch up with you in the end.
I know. I'd rather hope they do.
If you're so interested in getting caught, why did you ask me to help you escape last night?
Oh, well, that was different. I was enjoying myself. The truth is, I don't know the half of what I've done or how I really feel about... There isn't the time.
Why did you do it? Why did you run away?
It's something I've always wanted to do. Ever since I was a boy. Out and gone.
I did.
What?
Ran away.
Really?
Every school I was sent to, I hated.
I was never brave enough actually to do it.
What did you imagine would happen?
Oh, I'd join the circus, see the world, and then come home years later a grown man. My mother would open the door and she'd be crying and hugging me and...
I don't think Colonel Phillips is going to be so amenable.
I'm not frightened of what will happen to me.
So why don't you give yourself up?
I'm enjoying myself too much. Here we go.
Oh, what a lovely house.
Look, behind the gate.
I've always rather liked house stations.
Right.
Well, if I'm lucky, I might be able to talk to the Major's brother, Stephen Fenton.
I'm coming in with you.
Keep driving.
Why?
Policeman.
Oh, yes. Why is the policeman there?
Stop people like me, I suppose.
What are you going to do?
There must be another way in.
What?
Major Fenton is hiding something. I need to find out what.
Don't you think the police would have covered all this?
When you've got a man with his hands in the air saying it was me, I would imagine you don't spend days sifting through all the evidence. Stop here.
What are you planning to do?
Like my old school days, I'm going over the wall.
You're going to have to take your shoes off.
Yes, of course.
Now, your right foot in my hand.
This is the second time you've had to lift me. Are you sure you can manage?
I carried my best friend across the beach at Dunkirk. I'll be all right.
Did he survive?
No, he didn't. Foot, please. One, two.
Oh.
Can you see anything? Molly?
Yes. The dogs.
Where are they?
Well, they're looking right at me.
I'll lower you down.
No, wait.
What's happened?
Well, someone's coming out of the house. You're right.
Who is it?
I don't know.
If they call the police...
Don't move.
What?
He's looking at the dogs. And the dogs are looking at me.
What do you think you're doing?
It's Stephen, I think. He looks so like the Major.
Clear off out of here!
I'm sorry.
Are you people mad? Can't you understand how we might be feeling?
But your brother is in court today.
This is private land. You are trespassing.
Listen, I don't believe he killed Mrs. Fenton.
Don't say I didn't warn you.
Will you come and support him? Please.
What's happening now?
Well, he's going back inside.
You'd better come down.
I'm not actually on his land.
Well, I'm sinking into someone's down here.
I'm getting heavy.
He doesn't want to talk, Molly. He's too upset.
That's not grief. That's fear. Oh, my God.
What?
He's got a shotgun.
Down, now.
He must be really frightened.
I know how he feels. Get in the car.
My shoes.
Leave them. All right, over there. Molly?
I'm fine.
He could have killed you.
Yes, I know.
The Old Bailey?
Yes, later.
What about the trial? Aren't you meant to be reporting on it?
Sorry, I'm not used to this.
No, I can see that. What about some tea?
Yes, but first I must go to the hairdresser.
Are you serious?
Yes, I am. It's a matter of life and death.
Not seen you before?
No. I was a friend of Mrs. Fenton.
Oh, yes. Terrible business.
I understand her husband is on trial for her murder.
Yes.
Do you know him?
Mrs. Fenton was a regular.
I've just been talking with Stephen Fenton.
Oh, yes.
He seems terribly upset. From what I know of the Major, it's hard to believe that he could do such a thing.
It came as something of a surprise. He was always so happy.
Yes. I went down to the court today. I saw Major Fenton. I shall never forget the look on his face.
It came as something of a surprise that his wife was seeing Edward Benson. Not that I blame her for that, of course. You don't know where you are these days, do you? With the war, with everything.
Would you happen to know where Mr. Benson lives? Please. I want to help. That's all. I'll do no harm.
The harm has already been done.
Yes. Does he live locally, Edward Benson?
He has a garage off the Finchley Road.
Why do you think...
Look, please. I'd rather keep out of all this. If you don't mind. I love the wireless, don't you? It really does help keep your mind off things.
She was hiding something.
You always this suspicious.
She liked Mrs. Fenton and Major Fenton. I couldn't believe it, she said.
That he killed her?
That she would have an affair with another man. She clearly acted out of character.
We all do that from time to time.
Yes. But the way she was not looking at me...
She was cutting your hair.
She was definitely frightened by something. We'll have to be very careful with him.
Edward Benson.
There's no telling how he'll react.
I used to watch him race. Before the war. Had an almighty crash, I remember. Smashed his legs.
She was always so happy.
Who?
Mrs. Benson. According to the hairdresser.
Are you?
What?
Happy.
Yes. I think so. I don't know. Are you?
Never have I been happier. You look so different with your hair short.
Well, it was time for a change.
Hello?
Under here.
Mr. Benson?
Pass me that spanner, would you?
This one?
It's the wrong size, but it'll have to do for the moment.
Here you go.
I like the footwear. Very stylish.
Thanks. George used to watch you racing.
Glory days, long gone.
I was there when you crashed. I couldn't believe it when you came out in one piece.
Everyone keeps telling me I'm lucky to be alive.
And you don't think so?
Damn it! Where the hell is that wrench? I should be flying hurricanes, not hobbling underneath this bloody thing. Excuse my French. Is it a car you need repairing?
No, it's about Mrs. Fenton.
Oh, is it indeed?
Mr. Benson?
God, it was here. I know it was here.
Why are you not at the trial?
Why would I be?
I would have thought, as a witness.
Well, you thought wrong. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a car to repair.
How did Major Fenton know that his wife was seeing you?
She wasn't seeing me. I took her out driving a few times to help her with her work.
What work?
She was a volunteer ambulance driver. She thought I could help her drive it faster.
Look, I know how you must feel. Someone you know, someone you perhaps love.
Who said I loved her?
Well, if you didn't, why do you think she told the Major about you?
Mrs. Fenton had very strong religious beliefs. A Catholic. There's no way that even if I'd tried, she would have allowed any intimacy between us.
I saw Stephen.
Fenton.
He's not a happy man.
Stephen Fenton has never been a happy man. He's always tried to do better than his brother, but the harder he tries, the more he fails.
How well did you know them, the Fenton brothers?
They are, both of them, very possessive, jealous types. Stephen, mostly.
Jealous enough to commit murder?
Who knows what men are capable of, especially now. Wearing a soldier's uniform can turn a man's head, make him think he's invincible, and then, at the same time, his wife is at home driving ambulances, working in factories, goodness knows what else. People are changing all over the bloody place.
Is this what happened to Mrs. Fenton? The Major came home and found a wife he no longer recognised.
If you want to get back to the Old Bailey...
Did Stephen tell him about you and Mrs. Fenton, do you
I've
think?
I've nothing more to say. Get out, you bastard! You say in your report, Mr. Hardcastle, that Mrs. Fenton in all likelihood had her back to the Major.
No, I didn't. I said without question she had her back to whoever killed her.
Yes. Major Fenton says that his wife was on the floor when he hit her.
Mrs. Fenton was not lying on the floor when she received the blow that killed her.
How can you be so sure?
Given the force with which she was hit, she would, had she been lying on the ground, have incurred a considerable amount of bruising to the face.
Could she not have fallen onto a cushion?
There was no cushion on the floor.
Perhaps it was removed, along with the weapon that killed her. Is it possible?
In my considered opinion, given the evidence before me, Mrs. Fenton was not lying on the floor.
But when... is it possible, Mr. Hardcastle?
It is possible, Mr. Alexander, but extremely unlikely.
Have I missed anything? What's happening?
Quiet. This theory concerning the position of Mrs. Fenton, having told her husband about the affair and seeing him in an uncontrollable rage, why would she then sit with her back to him?
Didn't tell him she wasn't having an affair with Benson.
Mr. Hardcastle?
I am a pathologist, Mr. Alexander, not a mind reader.
Major Fenton's brother says that he heard the noise and went in to see what was happening. He saw Mrs. Fenton lying on the floor. He went to help Mrs. Fenton, trying to resuscitate her. And yet you say that it was several hours after her death that the body was moved.
That is correct.
It would seem to me, Mr. Hardcastle, that your report is at odds with both the man who has confessed to the crime and the one man who witnessed it. Two officers in His Majesty's Army, both of whom have risked their lives for their country. Are you suggesting they are liars, Mr. Hardcastle?
I believe only what the microscope and the scalpel reveal to me. Mrs. Fenton's death was not the result of a violent struggle. Mrs. Fenton was killed from behind and left to die in cold blood.
Look at his face.
Who? Hardcastle?
No. The Major.
He's crying?
Yes.
What a mess.
Yes. Terrible, terrible mess.
How's it going, Molly?
We're not sure he did it.
We? Who are we? You're a reporter, Molly, not Sherlock Bloody Holmes.
Oh, no, sir.
Let me read what you've got so far.
Oh, it's not finished. It's a lot more complicated, a lot messier than...
I don't like mess, and I don't like complications. Beginning, middle...
Aren't you interested in the truth?
I'm interested in selling newspapers.
What if the Major didn't actually do it?
Why did he confess to it, then? Why is he on trial?
Oh, you see how interesting it is with all these unanswered questions.
My whole life is about unanswered questions. When are the Germans going to invade? Will they still want newspapers? Is my eldest boy going to drown in the cold Atlantic Sea? I don't like these questions. In fact, I hate them. I rely on my newspapers to supply me with some answers, some comfort.
I didn't know your son was in the Navy.
Merchant Navy, please.
What's his name?
Never mind his name. Major Fenton is a war hero, yes?
Yes.
He accidentally killed his wife, yes? Molly, if we start questioning everything that we are fighting for, our heroes, our justice system, we are left with nothing.
Doing?
The paper goes to print tomorrow, Molly. As yet, I don't have a front page.
You don't know the story.
Right, headline.
But
war hero fights for his life.
No. He doesn't give a damn what happens to him.
He will, come his last meal. What's all this about Hardcastle?
Well, his evidence shows that it can't have been manslaughter.
That's it. Thank you, Molly.
What?
War hero fights Hardcastle's evidence.
Mr. Hardcastle doesn't want him to hang.
How do you know?
Well, I've spoken with him. He showed me the photos of Mrs. Fenton.
Have you got them?
No.
Oh, bloody hell, Molly!
He can't help the evidence.
I'll bet if it was his son up there on trial for murder, he'd soon see it differently.
Major Fenton didn't murder his wife.
His QC is going for manslaughter.
No, he didn't do it.
What's the story, then?
I don't know.
I took a chance on you, Molly.
You didn't see the Major's face.
Go home.
What about the story?
What story? High-ranking medal-wearing army officer on trial for the brutal murder of his wife at the Old Bailey? According to you, there is no bloody story.
There will be. I promise. Please.
Get out, Molly.
What?
Now, before I throw you out.
Here you are, chops.
I got them special. See a queue, join it. That's my philosophy. Your favourites for afters. Stewed fruit and junket.
Something to look forward to.
That soldier came round earlier.
Soldier?
Said his name was George.
Oh, yes. George. Two left feet and a very beautiful mouth.
You're going dancing, he said.
Oh, I can't. Not tonight. Did you ever have an affair? Mrs. B?
Oh, beg your pardon.
An affair?
No, I did not.
Were you ever tempted?
What?
To have an affair?
Why would I?
Your husband's away. You're bored. You want some company.
Is that all you think marriage is?
No.
My husband was often away. I was too busy to get bored. Sometimes at night. God, I missed him. It didn't enter my head to have an affair. We're not all fly-by-nights, you know.
I don't think Mrs. Fenton was that sort either.
No. Nor do I.
So what happened?
I'll tell you something. When my husband was away, his family had come and called to see me. His mother nearly drove me around the bend. His brother used to pop round too. Said he wanted to make sure I was being true to my husband, and all the while he was saying things, hinting at things.
What things?
Nothing you could pin down. The way he looked at me, how he was with me. He'd sometimes brush past me, get a bit too close, make suggestions.
Why didn't you say anything?
Who to?
Your husband.
And what? Turn brother against brother? Rip a whole family to pieces? No. It's not those from outside who pose most danger, but those from the inside, the family. Those who can come and go without suspicion.
Oh, it's you.
Sorry to disturb you at home, Mr. Hardcastle.
You were at the Old Bailey today.
Yes, that's right.
Do you know what the time is?
I think I know what happened to Mrs. Fenton.
You're a reporter.
I know you don't want to talk to them, but
my predecessors used the press to enhance their reputations. They became impregnable. Everything they said in court was believed. I won't let that happen to me.
Mrs. Fenton was not having an affair with Edward Benson.
Then why did you tell the Major that she was?
I don't think she did.
So why did he kill her?
He didn't.
Ah, he's confessed to a crime he neither committed nor had the motive.
I believe he's covering for someone else.
Who?
Someone close enough to matter to him.
His brother?
Is the most obvious suspect.
Why would he have done all this?
To protect him. Have you met Stephen?
Briefly.
According to Edward Benson, Stephen was very jealous of his brother. His house, his wife, his war record.
If he killed Mrs. Fenton, as you're suggesting, why on earth is the Major protecting him?
I don't know. When I tried to talk to Stephen, he took a pop at me with his shotgun.
Interfering reporters who disturb people day and night deserve all they get.
I wonder if you could persuade the police to ask the Major about his brother, about coming home and finding the
body. The police have been trying to get him to answer these questions from the beginning, but all he says is, it was my fault, I'm to blame.
When he heard your evidence, the details of how his wife was killed, he was deeply shaken. I think he genuinely believed that his wife fought for her life, or that she died as a result of some tragic, violent outburst.
Well, thank you for calling. Try using the telephone next time.
I don't have one. What are you going to do?
Sleep. I suggest you do the same. Good night.
Good night.
Come on, Major Fenton, the public.
Major Fenton!
My client has nothing further to say.
Oh, Major Fenton, please, come on. Come on. Oh, Major Fenton, why did you confess to a crime he did not commit?
Major Fenton!
Jack! What's happening?
Hardcastle came up with some new evidence. The police are questioning the Major's brother.
Major Fenton! Major Fenton!
Mr. Hardcastle?
Molly, how nice to see you.
What happened?
I simply told Inspector Andrews what we had discussed, and he went to talk to both the Major and his brother.
Did Stephen murder Mrs. Fenton?
Yes, he did. He wanted to have an affair with Mrs. Fenton. Not because he loved her, but to prove something to himself and to his brother.
And she said no.
So it would seem. When Stephen found out that she was seeing Benson, innocent though it was...
He flew into a jealous rage and killed her.
Well, no. He stole a wrench from Benson's garage to make it look like Benson's doing, and killed her much as I described, in cold blood. If he couldn't have her, then no one could.
I understand all of that, or rather I think I do. But why did the Major confess?
He's an honourable man. He decided that he was the one who was ultimately responsible.
Even though his brother had murdered his wife?
Stephen must have lied to his brother. Said that there was a fight over Benson and that he was protecting the family name.
Will Stephen be convicted?
On the evidence, yes, he will.
So, I have helped save the Major but managed to condemn his brother.
You have helped reveal the truth of what happened. There are mitigating circumstances. The court may be lenient.
Molly!
George!
How long have you known him?
George? 2 days. Why do you ask?
Just be careful.
Where were you last night?
Good day to you.
Yes, goodbye, Mr. Hardcastle.
I waited hours for you.
Oh, I had work to do. The Major is innocent. We were right.
I want to get married, Molly.
Who to?
You. I know. Too fast. Too fast.
Please, George.
I love you.
You don't even know me.
I know, but I want to, Molly. Really know you.
And I don't know anything about you.
Well, I wear coats that don't fit me properly. I drive like a lunatic. I can't dance very
you
well.
You ran away from the army.
I'm not like Major Fenton.
How do you mean?
Not lying to you.
What the Major did was honourable.
You don't think I'm honourable?
I didn't say that. I just want to know why you decided not to climb aboard the train that would take you back to your regiment.
Everything I say in way of explanation will sound like a feeble excuse.
I'd like to hear it. Whatever it is. However it sounds, I need to know.
What? What do you want from me?
The truth, George! That's all.
The truth? Right. Here's the truth. Until I met you, I didn't know what I was doing with my life. It was a mess. A long, dark, endless tunnel. Nothing made sense to me. I could feel and hear and see nothing. But now, because of you, that's the truth. I've got something for you.
A ring?
No, that would be going too fast. Here.
A necklace.
Mother of Pearl.
I don't know what to say.
Then the best thing to do is say nothing. just agree to come out with me tonight.
What time is it?
At the Palais.
Oh, my sorry. I've missed the deadline. Was my story.
I can do it, Molly, because it's my newspaper. And yes, Molly, it was your story, but no, it's not.
I was right, though, wasn't I? About Major Fenton.
Yes, you were, but you were too late. You failed.
I uncovered the story.
You got too involved.
It's because of me the Major has got off.
And what happens next time? When you do a big story and start questioning the whole of bloody London about it.
I was doing my job.
No, you weren't. You were doing someone else's.
I worked bloody hard to save that man's life.
How old are you?
19.
My son is 19. When he first came home from sailing the Atlantic, I didn't recognize him. He looked older than his grandfather. He couldn't speak. We could hear him at night. I wanted to go in and just hold him and tell him that everything was going to be all right. But I couldn't do it. Don't tell me that you work hard. That what you do saves people's lives. Mr. Hardcastle believes you're in the wrong job.
You spoke with him.
And what's more, Molly, I agree with him.
Are you firing me? Before you answer that, I resign. On a matter of principle.
That's what I like about you, Molly. Your matters of principle. The way things are going, there'll be no place for people like you in journalism. Where are you off to now?
Hardcastle had no right to call you.
No, perhaps not. But he's right, Molly.
Your son?
I thought you'd gone.
Have you had any word?
His convoy was due home 4 days ago.
I'm sorry.
You're not the only one.
Oh, good, you're back.
Mrs. B, you won't believe what has happened to me.
Molly.
I've lost my job.
Oh, no.
I helped Mr. Hardcastle and the police, and what does he do? He telephones my editor and gets me the sack.
There's a gentleman here to see you.
George. You.
Yes, me.
My editor has sacked me, or rather I was forced to resign because of you.
I never knew I held such sway with the press.
You said I was in the wrong job.
You are. Were. I hate to see someone wasted on something they're unsuited for.
Shall I get you some more tea?
No!
Yes, thank you.
What are you doing here? If you've come to apologize, it's too late.
How much do you know about George Blackburn?
George?
What has he told you about his circumstances?
He had a weekend pass and hasn't gone back. Have you told the police?
No.
If you have...
He's a deserter, Molly.
A deserter? He was at Dunkirk. He tried to rescue his friend.
I'm not suggesting he's not brave, Molly. I'm concerned that if you help him or harbour him, that you will be an accessory to a very serious crime.
I see. He wants to marry me.
Whatever happens, he will be caught. The army don't like it when one of their own dishonours them.
I knew there was something. I asked him to tell me, but he wouldn't. Do you know?
What?
Why he did it, why he deserted.
You're seeing him again?
Tonight.
I know of the circumstances of his desertion, but I think he should be the one to give you his reasons.
Thank you for coming here.
It's been quite a day.
You all right?
Yes. Fine.
Is it something I've said?
I lost my job.
Oh. Have you thought about what I asked you?
I know, George.
What?
That you were a deserter.
I hate that word.
Is it true?
I thought you said you knew.
I don't want to believe it.
Well, yes. Technically, I am a deserter.
Why did you lie to me?
I didn't lie.
You said you had a weekend pass.
I did have a weekend pass.
I thought you meant the weekend just gone, not 2 bloody months ago.
I'm giving myself up. Because of you, Molly.
I do
so want to believe you, George.
I thought that if I told you...
Well, I wouldn't have helped you.
Would you?
No. I don't think I would.
I think it would be better if we sit this one out.
No, please. Best to keep moving.
Hardcastle told you, didn't he?
Does it matter?
It matters a great deal. I don't want to be caught. Not now. I want to give myself up. Do the honourable thing and all that. Has he told anyone else?
I don't know. I doubt it. He knows what you mean to me. What happened, George? I need to know.
I lost faith.
In what?
In me. In mankind. The war.
So do a lot of people. That doesn't make them all deserters. George.
Why did Major Fenton cover for his brother?
I don't know.
I do. He was the one who was responsible.
No.
Not for the murder, the actual doing of it, but for everything else. For allowing it to happen. He was the one. I didn't hear the air raid sirens.
They went off ages ago.
Don't you ever go into a shelter?
Not if I can help it. Best take it as it comes.
Move.
Where to?
Under the table.
George!
Don't worry, I'll cover you.
Shut your mouth and keep still.
Molly. Molly?
Mm? Oh. Hello.
You're in hospital, dear.
How are you feeling, Molly?
I don't rightly know.
You are lucky. A few cuts and bruises.
What about George?
Oh, I'm not sure you should get up.
No, I want to. I feel fine. Is George dead?
No, he's not.
But it's best you know the truth.
He might not pull through.
Yes. Thank you. Can I see him?
I'll go and find out for you.
Thank you, Mrs. B. Where are my shoes?
I don't know.
So lucky with shoes.
It's probably best that you get some
rest. I can't sleep.
No.
You married Mr. Hardcastle?
I was, yes. She's no longer alive.
Oh.
Elizabeth rented a cottage up in Scotland to finish a book.
She was a writer.
An artist, illustrator. A very good one, as it happens.
I'm sorry. I shouldn't have asked.
No, no, I don't mind talking about her. I like talking about her. It helps. People don't usually ask.
How did she die?
That I don't know.
Oh, God. I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to upset you.
No. It's a shock, I think.
Of course it is.
I told George that no matter what happened, he'd be safe with me. He covered my body with his.
Here. Have this. Have you noticed they don't make handkerchiefs nearly big enough these days?
No.
Molly, I'm sorry that you lost your job. It wasn't my intention.
Oh, you were right. It wasn't for me.
What will you do?
I don't know. I've not thought.
Molly!
What's happened? Is it George?
Molly?
Hello, George.
I knew something was going to happen. I said...
No.
You look so beautiful. You're all right.
You saved my life.
No, Molly. You saved mine.
Don't die, George.
Going home at last.
No, please, George.
Molly.
Yes. I'm here.
Will you do something for me? Go and work for Hardcastle.
What? How? He wouldn't want me.
You must try. Ask him.
Why do you want me to?
He's... You don't often find men of his caliber.
I know he's brilliant, but...
There's something else.
What do you mean?
I owe him a debt, Molly. A real debt. He was...
George?
He saved me from being shot. Promise me you'll ask him?
Yes, I will. I promise.
Good, good. Don't worry, Molly. It's got your name on it.
George.
My life isn't all glamorous murder investigations that go to the Old Bailey. I work in prisons, asylums, hospitals. Most of the mortuaries I have to attend are outdated. They're run-down, smelly, disgusting buildings that have never, I don't think, ever had a woman in them. Except when she's dead, of course. And the places I have to go to, the back alleys, the filthy courtyards, rat-infested tenements. And then there's the unearthing of half-eaten bodies in spinneys and cottages, decomposing corpses in pub toilets, in ditches and old tin baths.
Before you go on, Mr. Hardcastle, I wonder, could you tell me about George? I need to know. Please.
You know he was at Dunkirk?
Yes. He tried to save his friend.
George and a few of the platoon that survived found themselves in a hotel in Dover. There at the bar, sipping their malt whiskies, were two RAF officers. The fight was inevitable, the outcome tragic.
He killed an RAF officer.
From where the army was standing on the beach at Dunkirk, the RAF were nowhere to be seen. In that bar in Dover, two of them were asked why. A flight lieutenant was killed. The other seriously injured. Who did what to whom was unclear, but George, as the senior officer, took full responsibility. The evidence said otherwise, and I managed to clear his name. But something had happened on the beach at Dunkirk. At the hotel in Dover, and afterwards during the investigation.
He lost faith.
And deserted.
He was going to go back to his regiment. Everything was going to be all right.
You best sit down, Molly.
I feel... Oh, God.
It comes in waves.
What?
Grief.
I was dancing a few hours ago, laughing, singing. Look at me. I'm shaking.
Look. Here's a blanket.
Thank you. I wasn't like this at the funeral. I wasn't like anything. Were you there?
After Elizabeth died, I made a vow. No more funerals.
I feel numb.
That's the way of it.
Oh, I think you should get some sleep. I'm sorry I disturbed you.
You must be tired.
Oh, I think I'll sleep until Christmas. Is that a picture of your wife?
Yes.
She's very beautiful. You must miss her. George kept asking these silly questions about love at first sight and knowing when your time is up. Do you believe in any of that?
No. Do you?
I believe that George led me to you.
Yes, but I can't have you shaking like a leaf at every dead body. How do I know you'll be strong enough?
Well, George thought so.
His death has upset you, has it not?
Well, you can see that it has.
George's story is but one of hundreds, thousands that will break your heart. The baby who was left to starve in a chest of drawers. The little girl whose dress caught fire. The tart savagely cut open by her client. The suicides, the failed abortions, the gas explosions, the direct hit on a crowded air raid shelter.
The unexplained death of a beautiful woman found in a cottage in Scotland.
Do you still want the job?
I would like to think about it.
Of course. Take as long as you need. I'll ring for a taxi. Yes, a taxi, please. Park. Thank you.
Mr. Hardcastle?
Yes, Molly.
I've thought about it. When do I start?
In Love at First Sight, the part of Molly was played by Emily Bruni. George, Bob Cryer, and Hardcastle, James Hazeldine. Mrs. B was played by Sheila Reed. Benson, Anthony Carf. The editor, Jonathan Hackett. And Alexander QC by Nick Waring. Other parts were played by members of the cast. Love at First Sight was written by Michael Crompton, directed by John Dove, and is a Catherine Bailey Limited production for BBC Radio 4.
Just before our Saturday play, The Wigwam Murder, starring Emily Bruni as Molly and Kevin Whateley as Hardcastle, Molly Lefebvre talks about her experiences of forensic science and the advances made during her time as a pathologist secretary in the Second World War, which led her to write the book, Murder on the Home Front.
We opened up a whole new vista of forensic medicine, which hadn't been explored before. Well, one, for example, was the Dobkin case, when we had this little sort of parcel of bones that had been found in a graveyard in Kennington. And then they brought it back to Guy's and wrapped it in a sheet and put her below my desk so that I used to sit with Mrs. Dobkin, but we didn't know who she was then, below my desk, which I didn't like very much. We just had bones and a skull detached from the bones. No identification at all. Really, we identified her through the dental surgeon. We managed to find her dental surgeon. And his dental records were what proved that she was Mrs. Dobkin. And that was the first time that a dental record had been used so conclusively in a murder investigation. I think quite a lot of these cases, of course, that the murders were many of them connected with war, because the girls were often killed by soldiers. They were picked up and very often strangled and things like this. And so we had quite a supply of those cases, and the men used to come home and find their wives had been unfaithful to them and bump them off. All sorts of things like that.
Murder on the Home Front, Episode 3. The Wigwam Murder by Michael Crompton. Inspired by Molly Lefebvre's book of the same name. Spring, 1942.
Molly?
Mm-hmm.
It's the story. It upsets me.
All day working in mortuaries, looking at dead bodies, hearing the most dreadful things, and here you are crying over a stupid film.
Gone with the Wind is more than a film, Mrs. B.
You're telling me. Time it took felt more like three films.
Look at the queue to see the 2 o'clock showing.
I prefer something more English, with some laughs in it.
Everyone wants to escape.
What are you talking about?
Did you notice? When the siren sounded, nobody left.
Maybe they were all asleep.
Molly!
Mr. Hardcastle!
I thought it was you.
This is Mrs. B, my landlady.
Yes, we've met.
Oh, of course.
Were you watching the film?
No.
I wouldn't bother.
How did you know I'd be here?
Well, you told me yourself yesterday, Molly.
Well, we were just going for lunch. Do you want to join us?
I've had a telephone call. Scotland Yard.
Oh?
They've got something for us.
What is it this time? Not another murdered body? I don't know how you two cope.
We have to, Mrs. B. That's our job.
Where are we going?
Hankley Common.
You got on me.
You know it.
I was brought up there. I used to play on the common. It's lovely.
Well, you can show us the way.
I thought you were on holiday in Scotland.
I changed my mind.
You need a break.
It's the second anniversary of my wife's death.
I didn't realise.
I was going to Scotland too. I don't know. I changed my mind.
You've been doing 7 days a week for over 2 months now.
There's a war on, Molly.
Yes, but even those in the thick of the fighting are allowed to take leave. Slow down. Pull over there. School.
I thought you were sent away.
Not at five. I wonder how long they've been using it as a hospital.
Oh, do you think he is?
Which one?
In the wheelchair.
I don't know, 20, 25 maybe?
Younger, much younger. He's no older than Christopher, my son. Should be in his first year at university, not flying planes, all but losing his life.
Is your son in the Air Force?
Yes, he is, in the thick of the fighting.
Where's he based?
I'm not sure. I've not seen him since my wife's death.
I see.
He blames me for what happened. So does my daughter. That's somehow harder to bear.
That doesn't mean you have to work yourself to death.
He wouldn't miss me, that's for sure.
Why do you say that?
Here comes another one. I was meant to stay with Elizabeth in Scotland. We've not been away together for years, not alone. Go fishing, walking. Took up a paint and easel. So beautiful, the landscapes. But work. I had to go back. Or rather, I chose to go back. So when she died, she was on her own. I just wasn't there. Oh, listen to him. This is awful.
Where are they all coming from?
Looks like bomber crews on the forward bases. I don't know who suffers the most, the young men or their parents.
May I ask a question?
About my wife, how she died?
Yes.
I still don't know if I'm to blame. The official verdict was death by misadventure. The police were convinced that she'd taken her own life.
I'm so sorry.
She was found lying in the bath, drowned.
She fell asleep.
Elizabeth was a fiercely intelligent woman. She wouldn't have taken her own life, not just because of her religious convictions, but Elizabeth loved life. She loved me, our children, her work.
Did you see her? Examine the body.
No. I identified her.
What do you think might have happened?
Without all the fact. Whatever happened, it was my fault.
How do you know that?
We best go.
Why don't we walk through the woods? It won't take long.
You can. I don't feel up to it.
I'll stay with you.
I'll be fine, Molly. You walk. It's a lovely evening.
You've not told me why we're here.
I've not told you, Molly, because I don't know myself.
What?
A call from Scotland Yard, Hankley Common, ASAP. Is it straight on?
See there, where it says restricted access. Just follow the road round.
Are you sure you want to walk?
I'll probably get there before you do.
Well, you be careful.
Who's that? Are you all right?
You've not seen me, ma'am. You've not seen me.
What?
This way! Oh, I saw him. He was here. Over there. I saw someone. A woman. Did you see him? Shit, we've got to get him. Here she is.
Oh, Jesus.
Did you see her? She must have gone past you, not this way.
This chain of hats.
Shut up. What do we do?
We come back later.
The police have got some guy coming down from London.
We'll have to deal with it.
Do you think she saw us?
Whatever happens, we'll deal with it.
Now let's go.
Identification.
Your papers.
I'm on official business.
Are you blind? Can't you read? Army personnel only. Restricted access.
Scotland Yard asked me to...
Hardcastle.
Molly.
Oh, what's going on?
Stay where you are.
Please, this is Mr. Hardcastle, the Home Office pathologist.
The what?
Forensics. You didn't say that.
Yeah, because you didn't give me a chance.
Mr. Hardcastle?
You know this man?
Yes, I do. This is quite unacceptable.
We have orders to stop and search, sir.
This is England, for God's sake. Are you all right?
Oh, absolutely fine. The Allied forces working as one. Molly?
Yes?
You look as if you've seen a ghost.
I'll tell you later.
I suggest you leave your car here and we'll walk. It's not far. My name's Webb, Chief Inspector Webb, Scotland Yard. I'm so sorry about your welcoming committee. The whole place has gone off like a swarm of hornets.
This is my assistant, Molly.
How do you do? Good to have you here.
That's more than the Americans seem to think.
I should have warned you. Colonel Allen, the commanding officer here, has overreacted somewhat. We wanted to keep the whole thing under wraps. A body has been found.
On the common?
On the base itself. As I'm sure you're aware, the Americans have authority over their men and the bases on which they serve. As to what happens with regards to the conduct of army personnel, the government are in the process of making some sort of deal.
Yes, I know all about it. The Visiting Forces Act.
Ah, you've been consulted?
Unofficially, I have.
Surely if there's a serious crime, the British police are called in.
There are important questions of procedure, Molly, of law.
But if they break the law in this country, isn't it right that our judicial system takes care of them?
I gather the Americans want their forces to be exempt from prosecution in a British court.
I believe so.
So Hankley Common is a little piece of America now, is it?
Yes, I think it is.
Chief Inspector, is the body that of a soldier?
No, it's a woman.
Here in winter with our sledges.
Here we are.
Stay there, both of you.
What is it?
Who found her?
Military police officers.
When?
In the early hours.
Did they disturb anything?
I don't think so.
I need to know.
Well, one of the men had been a cop from New York, as he told me. He called the police before informing the colonel. Otherwise, I don't know what might have happened.
Yeah, hold my jacket, would you, Molly?
I wonder how long she's been there.
These flies will have started laying their eggs almost immediately. Mr. Hardcastle is an expert on maggot sizes.
As I suspected, there's not a mark on her. No blood. I want a very accurate record of this.
How was she killed if there's not a mark on her?
We'll need some photographs.
He's on his way.
Well, he should be here now.
When I was younger, this was the most frightening place on earth.
If you'd rather wait in the car, Molly.
So, in all probability, she might well have known her murderer.
I suggest before we start speculating, we concentrate on the evidence before us.
Yes. Of course. I was just thinking...
A young, naked woman without a mark on her. What evidence is there?
Footprints.
Where?
Exactly. There are none.
That's not possible.
The ground is soft and yet there's nothing.
She can't have just dropped from the sky.
I want the whole area cordoned off. What's that building over there?
The officer's mess, I believe.
From the officer's mess up to the woods over there and down to the bottom of the gully, all right?
Anything else?
No. Thank you, Chief Inspector.
Very well. I'll see what I can do.
Not a mark on her.
How do you think she got here?
I've no idea.
And why so close to the officer's mess? She was bound to be discovered.
She's on her side. Looks like she's asleep. She was placed here with care.
But how, when there are no footprints?
I don't know. Not yet. What happened to you earlier?
Yes, there were some soldiers.
Yeah, keep it quiet.
One ran past me going like the wind. He fell. He was being chased.
Who by?
Soldiers, at least two of them.
Did they catch him?
No, but one of them saw me and they started to chase me.
Why, for heaven's sake?
I just ran. They didn't want me to see something. It's a good thing I knew where I was going. I cut back on myself and managed to avoid them. We had a tree camp when I was younger. It was still there, completely overgrown. I hid there.
Would you recognize them again if you saw them?
I don't think so, no. It's difficult to see from where I was hiding.
Stop what you're doing!
Who's this?
I guess a captain and a colonel.
I did not give you permission to touch the body.
I don't need your permission.
This is an American base under my jurisdiction.
And this is a body of a murdered woman under my jurisdiction.
Where the hell is your photographer? You're disturbing evidence.
He wasn't murdered here.
I can't believe you people.
I shall also be filing an official complaint.
About being stopped and questioned at the gate? My soldiers were simply obeying their orders.
This concerns a group of your men.
What the hell are you talking about?
In the woods.
It'll all be in my report, a copy of which will be sent directly to both the Home Secretary and the American Chief of Staff.
Colonel Allen. Chief Inspector, I thought I made the situation clear to you. This body is not to be moved until I give the order.
I will move this body when I
see fit. Is that understood,
Mr. You may give the orders, Colonel, but as far as this body is concerned, you have absolutely no authority.
Sir, we came over from the States 2 weeks ago in a liner. It had to be a liner because sailing without an escort, nothing else was quick enough to get past the U-boat.
Colonel...
Mr. Webb, even then we'd barely made it. The British had made such a goddamn hash of the Atlantic. We are stationed here without any communication system. It took us nearly 2 days to locate this place because there are no signposts. We have no clear orders and even less morale. So far, I have seen damn little in your race to understand why we bother to come at all. I don't like you. I'll fight for you, but I don't have to like you. All that I ask in return is that you respect my orders when you're in an area occupied, even if temporarily, by the American flag. I hope I have made myself clear.
Captain.
Sir.
You have your orders.
Yes, sir.
Bastard.
We're all right, Mr. Hardcastle.
I'll talk to him.
Someone should.
Scotland Yard have been waiting to hear from the Home Office all day.
You might telephone them, see if they've got through.
This had to happen on the weekend.
What are we going to do?
Captain, what precisely are your orders?
The body is not to be moved, sir.
I have no intention... I'm sorry, Captain. I have no intention of moving this body until we have some photographs. Where the hell is he? Molly, I need to take some measurements.
Right.
Unless, Captain, you intend to shoot us both?
No, sir.
Let's get on with it. Be very careful where you tread, Molly. I want nothing disturbed.
I'll take my shoes off.
No, leave them on. I can identify your prints easily enough.
Right, well, here's the tape measure.
I'll need the thermometer.
Oh, I wonder, Captain, would you be so kind as to pass the small bag?
This one?
Yes, thank you.
Am I right in assuming this is a training camp, Captain? I see. Mum's the word.
Where are you from, Captain?
That's classified, Molly. Name, rank, and serial number. Isn't that right, Captain?
Charleston. I guess Charleston. Am I right?
Charleston? That's in the south.
Yeah, I know. You sound like Rhett Butler.
Clark Gable doesn't come from Charleston, miss. He's an OH-10 boy, same as me.
OH-10?
Ohio.
5'6".
Same as me.
Excuse me, sir. May I ask, what are you doing?
I wish I knew.
Mr. Hardcastle is the Home Office pathologist, and I'm his assistant.
Oh, you're from London?
No, not originally. I used to live around here. You can see our church over there. My mother was a bell ringer. All quiet now.
Captain, you have access to the entire common?
I guess.
And that includes the woods?
Some, not all.
And how do you keep people out?
Of the woods?
The base.
Usual ways. Fencing, wire, round-the-clock patrols.
So no one can gain access save through the main gate?
Nobody.
Day and night?
That's right, sir. It's a pretty efficient setup.
I'm sure it is, Captain. You're not being shut up in the cooler then, Inspector?
Scotland Yard have been in touch with Churchill. He's adamant that we be as accommodating as possible.
Accommodating?
That's right, sir.
So we leave the body here, do we?
The Colonel
will be... This woman was murdered, and it's my job to ascertain how. It's yours, Chief Inspector.
You need not tell me my job. If you have no idea how she was murdered, I don't suppose you can give me a head start on a possible suspect.
All I know, Chief Inspector, is that she was placed here a few hundred yards from the bottom of a gully, 200 yards from those woods, and just 50 yards from the officer's mess. That's all the information I have. And it's less than I've ever had on a case of this importance in my entire professional career. Moved it.
What?
The car.
I don't believe it. Do you think they searched it?
I wouldn't put it past them.
I thought we were all on the same side.
Not when it comes to murder, Molly. The men who chased you.
What about them?
You didn't see their faces.
Clearly, no.
Would you recognize their voices?
One of them seemed very nervous.
No, where they came from. Think hard.
Oh, I'm not sure.
Who did they sound most like? Scarlett O'Hara or Rhett Butler?
They were Confederates.
All of them?
Definitely.
Mr. Hardcastle...
Oh, no, here we go again.
Mr. Hardcastle, the Colonel would like to speak with you.
Would he?
If you wouldn't mind coming with me.
Do we have the choice?
I owe you something of an apology. I had no idea who you were. I had you figured for some local guy who was about to mess everything up.
Apology accepted. Can we go now?
We're working around the clock here, training troops for the North African front. I haven't had time to get ahead of the game.
I understand.
You don't, but listen. I'm in something of a difficult position here. We have a body, a murder victim, right?
I'll know more about the victim when I've examined the body more thoroughly. I've arranged for its removal and transportation back to Guy's.
May I look at it first? I will only proceed if I have your permission, Mr. Hardcastle. I don't want to tread on any toes here. I was a surgeon back home. I have an interest. And maybe, who knows, I could even be of some help. Not that you need any help. As commanding officer, I would also like to keep pace with all the information, so if it comes to a trial or whatever, I will have some first-hand knowledge of the salient facts.
It's not me you should be asking, Colonel. It's for the coroner to decide.
I already did that. He has no objection.
Then you'll have no objection to Chief Inspector Webb and his men staying to make sure that no one walks into the area I've cordoned off. Which I'll make a search of first thing tomorrow morning.
You work Sundays.
Is that a problem?
No problem, Mr. Hardcastle. No problem at all. I'm glad to see that there's someone in this country who works as hard as I do. Have a safe journey home. Both of you.
Thank you, Captain.
I'll escort you back to your car.
No need. I think we know the way. Good night.
Molly, may I speak with you?
I have to be getting back to London.
I know. I've got a weekend pass for tonight, and I...
Wanted a dancing partner?
Well, yes.
God, well, I don't normally...
Molly splits her life between the mortuaries and the dance halls.
Oh, right. Do you jitterbug, Lindy Hop?
Not very well, no.
I could teach you.
Well, I can't. We're examining the body tonight.
No, we're not. Go out, Molly. Enjoy yourself.
Mr. Hardcastle.
I could meet you anywhere you say, if you'd like.
I don't even know your name.
Oh, it's Richardson. Captain Joseph Richardson.
Colonel Allen is a worried man.
Why did you say that?
What?
To the captain about me dancing.
I thought that's what you wanted. You looked so like Rhett Butler.
I never said that. How dare you? I was just trying to help. You were asking him questions.
I don't believe a word. I saw you.
I'm very sorry, Mr. Hardcastle. I take objection to this.
I'm sorry. I don't know what's wrong with me. I feel like an unexploded bomb.
You need a holiday.
It's not just that.
Your wife?
A dead girl, just lying there. I can usually cut myself off, but for some reason, by now... Oh, I don't want to talk anymore. I'm sick of it. How slow can they go?
It's an army truck.
Thought these Yanks went at 100 miles an hour. Out the bloody way!
What are you doing? You're not going to make it.
I know.
Listen, I miss this. Where did that come from?
Here comes another one. Up there.
Are they fighting off training? I often wonder if I'm doing enough. Those men up there, boys, same age as me, risking their lives every day. And us, down here.
It's for you they do it. Not just for you, of course, for us. For here.
Your son, he must be very brave.
They say that the bravest are the ones that are the most frightened.
When did you last see your daughter?
At my wife's funeral.
Have you not tried since?
Oh, of course, I've written to her a few times. She works on my brother's farm. He tells me that she's stopped ripping the letters up, at least. We'd best get back.
Are you all right to drive?
I'll take you to the station.
I don't mind your driving that much.
No, I might stay a while.
Why?
Something Webb said about the Colonel. If he had been informed about the dead girl before the police were, he knows what might have happened.
You don't trust him.
They don't trust me.
I'll stay.
No, you go out. All work and no play.
What about you?
You can always say no, you know.
To whom?
To G.I. Joe.
What? And give up the opportunity to Lindy Hop?
us over here.
Who's that?
It's not so deep that you'll drown.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
That's my question, I think. If you don't cross now, they'll catch you.
Are they after you as well? Oh, this is no laughing matter.
Would you brighten up a little water?
No. Oh, shit. It's deep.
Come on, move it.
I'm going as fast as I can.
Over here.
Close.
Come on.
Let's best hide behind here. With me. You're the government man, right?
Yes. How do you know?
I saw you.
Why are you here?
Well, I was running, but there's nowhere to hide in this country. So I came back.
Over here, sir. But where did he go? Over the brook, sir.
Did you murder that young woman? Son of a bitch!
Oh, let me go!
Were you saying I did?
Christ!
Oh, is that what you're saying?
No! Let me go!
They're gonna catch you.
And you.
Only when I'm ready. And you better be careful out here. Same as that young lady I saw you with.
Who's it you she saw this afternoon?
Oh, this is a very dangerous place.
Do you know who she was? The victim?
Sure. Everyone knows.
Cross over here. Come
on, sir. I thought the dogs might become scent across the water. There's no wind. What about it?
It's right behind us.
Is it?
What's so frightened about?
I thought you were going to kill.
Not me. Oh, no, you're not frightened of me. It's you. And you. I can smell it. Real fear.
We're over here! Over here! Get that damn light out of my face!
Stand up! Against the tree!
We aren't exactly breaking the law.
We?
Colonel!
Who's we?
He was right here.
Who?
I'm getting too used to being dogged by my assistant.
She's with Captain Richardson, I understand.
Yes.
And what exactly are you doing, Mr. Hardcastle, alone in the dark, soaking wet, talking to yourself?
Protecting my interests.
Mr. Webb told me about you. He said you were the best man in the country.
I was very kind.
I see some of my men get like you when they can't stop, can't sleep, driving themselves and their men into the ground. They become a danger to themselves and the whole operation.
Damn you.
I suggest you return to your car and go home. Back to London. We'll see you first thing tomorrow, as arranged.
Hold on!
No!
You just gotta let go.
I don't want to.
You have to, Mo. One, two.
Oh, I can't believe it.
Here we go again.
Hold on to me.
I'll touch you.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that was so frightening.
Again.
No.
Here we go.
Oh, my God.
You did it, Mo.
I hit the ceiling.
You like it?
I love it. Again.
Oh, you sure?
Come on.
Let you jump up. I'll walk right under you.
What?
You can do it.
If you say so.
Here we go.
Yes. Yeah. Oh. Amazing.
Ooh, you learn fast.
You're a good teacher.
It's cooler out here.
Yes.
A cigarette?
Have one of mine.
No.
Yes, I insist. Oh,
thank you.
That's better.
It gets hot.
Sure does.
Hey, was that an American accent, Molly?
Yes, God, embarrassing. That was so good.
Yeah.
The dancing, I just lose myself.
Is that St. Paul's over there?
Isn't it beautiful?
That looks mighty vulnerable lit up like that.
They can't black out the moon.
How the hell happened the Germans hit it?
It's protected.
You believe?
Yes, I do. A few years ago I wouldn't have done, but now it has to be. There's no other explanation. What's America like?
Big.
I know that. Is it like the films?
Sure. Some in color, some in black and white.
Oh, I love to see it. New York. The Statue of Liberty.
Yeah.
What did you do before the war?
All these questions.
Oh, okay, I don't want to know. Not really. Let's just live now in the moment, okay? Are you all right?
Can I speak to you in confidence?
If it's about work, the murder of the girl, if you know something...
No, it's not about the girl. It's about you.
Me?
Yeah. Be careful, Molly. You have to be real careful.
What does that mean?
You were seen.
In the woods? Are you talking about? Were you there?
No.
You were?
No.
Who then?
There are some people. Some things they believe in. America's a big place, you know? A lot of different people who are now all together, and it sure as hell feels strange.
I don't understand.
Say all the European countries had to be in one big army, and you found yourself alongside a German or an Italian, a fascist. And it doesn't matter what you think, because we're all on the same side.
Those men who chased me.
Just be careful, Molly. Please. That's all I can say. You want to dance some more?
I think I want to spend the night with you.
Wow.
I can't believe I just said that.
Me neither.
I'm not even blind to the wide.
What's that?
I'm not drunk. I want to sleep with you, make love with you. You must think I'm dreadful to ask. I suppose it is, but I... What does Scarlet say? Tomorrow is another day. We both know that tomorrow we might not even be here.
But what do we do?
Well, I was hoping you'd know. Well,
I didn't mean that.
Well, you know, I've not done this before. I mean, been with anyone.
Oh. A real-life unpicked English rose. Where were you thinking? Where exactly were you proposing?
Well, I can't take you home to Mrs. B. She wouldn't approve, and not a hotel. You know, Mr. and Mrs. Smith, I couldn't go through with that. This is ridiculous. I don't know what I'm saying. Is this what Lindy hopping does to people?
How about we just walk?
Yes. Yes. Let's just do that. Let's walk.
Where is this?
Green Park.
Oh, is that the palace?
Yeah, it is. It's amazing how dark London can be in a blackout.
You're safe with me.
You don't think those men are here, do you?
No, they're not here.
You know, she was murdered sometime Friday night.
Most of the men were on leave Friday.
Fewer potential suspects.
I guess. You know how she died?
Not yet. She and we'll examine her sometime tomorrow.
You ever mind what you do?
Mind?
Looking at dead bodies.
Oh, no, you get used to it.
Not sure I could.
I used to be a reporter on a paper.
Must be well after midnight.
Yes.
Half the American army must be here.
Not very romantic, is it?
Yeah. Look, if you've changed your mind...
No, no. I wonder, before we... Do you think you could kiss me? Mrs. B, you surprised me. Were you waiting up?
No.
What time is it?
Coming up to six.
My watch has stopped.
Where have you been? What have you done to your coat?
What?
It's covered in grass.
I need a bath.
Molly, what's happened? Has someone hurt you?
No, I went dancing.
With that American?
He taught me to Lindy Hop. He... Oh, Mrs. B.
He didn't force himself on you, did
no,
he?
No, no, I wanted him to. I even went prepared. Can't believe it.
My first time was outside.
Was it?
Got a cold bum and I was bitten. Bloody midges. That's better.
It was awful, Mrs. B. Really awful.
Why tonight? With this American?
Oh, malaria.
I beg your pardon?
It's what it feels like.
The war, you mean?
Yes. Do you feel it?
We all do, Molly, from time to time. Doesn't mean to say we run off with the nearest good-looking American.
I thought it would snap me out of it. That's why I've been to see Gone with the Wind 6 times. Some people drink. Some start new allotments, a new baby. My mother has started to read all the great Russian novels in Russian. You know the worst of it, Mrs. B.
What, dear?
I've stopped saying when this war is over.
It will be. You'll see.
Oh, I wish I could just run into a cold sea. I want some colour. Or a bright star.
I'll boil you some water.
Yes, thank you.
Oh, that old editor of yours phoned.
Mr. McNabb.
I said you'd call as soon as you got in.
Excellent, yes. I need to see him.
You're not going to work on the newspaper again,
no,
are you?
No, of course not.
He said you were to be careful, Molly.
What? Why? What do you mean?
Just that. He sounded worried.
Did he? What about?
About you.
look.
What are you doing up here?
The river, Molly. Look at it. The best view in London.
The docks, or rather what's left of them. I like watching the boats, the ones that make it home. Those warehouses have been burning for days now. I hope you've got a good story for me.
No.
I hear they found a girl murdered down near Guildford.
I need your help.
Yes, you do. She was murdered by a Yank.
We don't know that.
I do. They're trying to cover it up.
You're joking. Who are?
And Hardcastle sending in an official complaint.
How do you know about that?
A colleague of mine working in Guildford went to have a little snoop and was told in no uncertain terms that he was to keep well away. Now, he's not easily frightened, Molly, but he's frightened now.
It's not why I'm here.
You and Hardcastle had better be careful.
Mr. Hardcastle's wife went to Scotland on a holiday 2 years ago and was found dead.
Well, let's hope the same doesn't happen to him.
It was thought she'd committed suicide.
I didn't know that.
That's not a story for you to print.
What do you take me for, Molly?
Mr. Hardcastle wasn't allowed to examine the body.
So what happened?
You have some friends up there. Contacts.
I'll see what I can do then. You look tired, Molly.
Telephone me at home. Not at work.
Does Hardcastle not know you're doing this?
I think he believes his wife was murdered. If I can help find out who or why, I believe it might make his life worth living.
Bad as that, is it?
He can't go on much longer like this.
He's got to watch his step with those Yanks. And so have you.
Young woman. Early 20s. Height 5'6". Approximate time of death. Young woman, early 20s, height 5'6". Approximate time of death.
Sorry.
You're late.
Oh, the bus ran out of petrol. I had to walk the last half mile.
You shouldn't have waited.
I didn't know we were leaving so early.
I phoned you last night.
Well, I was out.
I know that, with G.I. Joe.
You encouraged it.
I did not encourage you to turn up 20 minutes late, looking like death warmed up. How much sleep have you had? None by the looks of it.
It won't happen again.
If you're going to make a habit of behaving like this, I suggest you consider whether you're in the right profession. Can we go now?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
So am I. Mr. Hardcastle.
Yes?
How much sleep did you get last night?
There was work to do. As there is now. Come on.
Hardcastle.
Colonel Ireland. Captain Richardson.
Sir, I thought you might have gotten here a little earlier.
I hope the cordoned off area hasn't been trampled over.
It won't matter if it has.
You've got the murderer.
One of my men decided to go AWOL, make a run for it. We soon tracked him down.
Does Chief Inspector Webb know this?
He's interviewing the man right now.
I'll still need to make a detailed inspection, Colonel.
Of course. The whole area has been guarded throughout the night.
Good.
Damn right it's good. We now know that the victim's name is Florence Green. She was 20 years old and she was murdered where she was found.
Are you sure, Colonel?
There were no marks on the ground.
We also know that she told him she was pregnant.
She wasn't, though.
You examined her?
Earlier this morning.
Why didn't you...
Whether she was pregnant or not, it's what she told him. She tried to force him to marry her. Us Americans seem to be a means of escape for some of your women.
How did he kill her?
That we don't know. He's not told us as yet.
She died of a heart attack.
Well, that's the answer. She told him she was pregnant. He got mad. Must have frightened her to death.
How would he have done that?
He has a long record of violent offenses.
So how did he get into the army?
He had a choice. Serve time or join up.
What's his name?
Private August Ferron.
A colored?
No, ma'am, he's not a colored. He's some sort of Indian.
He's half French-Canadian, half Cree.
In the woods over there, he built himself a wigwam.
A wigwam?
Florence Green had been living with him in it. Her clothes were all over the place, a diary, some personal things. It beggars belief. They must have had an argument. He chased her out. She ran down here, frightened to death. Who can blame her, hunted by an animal?
We don't know that for sure, sir.
Captain?
Looks like it's going to rain.
Where are you going?
To the gully.
But what the hell for?
Molly, I'll need your help.
Yes, of course.
Captain.
Sir.
We'll need some umbrellas.
Sir.
Careful where you tread, Molly.
Oh, this is the second pair of stockings I'm about to ruin. What are we looking for?
Not sure. Footprints, marks on the ground, anything.
I thought she ran from the woods.
Maybe, maybe not.
They've arrested someone who's admitted to killing her.
So how did he do it?
You said yourself she had a heart attack.
What's that? Over there.
Footprints. The whole area has been disturbed.
Yeah, and not by just one person.
I don't understand. What does this mean?
Molly!
Who's this?
Joe.
Hi.
I'm working.
I thought you might want an umbrella.
No, we're fine.
Will you not
walk there, please?
Oh, sure. Have you found something?
Please.
Can we talk?
No, later.
You can go, Molly, if you...
Mr. Hardcastle and I...
Molly, stay or go.
I'll meet you in the canteen.
Okay.
Sorry.
Work and pleasure.
Do you think I'm enjoying this? Him, you, any of this? Let's concentrate on the evidence, shall we? Please.
She ran from over there.
That's the officer's note.
From that direction.
That doesn't make any sense. She was being chased. Surely she'd head towards it for safety.
Unless those that were chasing her were officers.
Officers?
Yes, three, maybe four.
I don't believe it. Officers wouldn't. Besides, Private Ferron has been caught.
Yes, he has.
So why are you fighting that? Is it because of Colonel Allen? Because somehow he's right and you're wrong.
Who was chasing?
Ferron.
Wearing four pairs of shoes?
There are no footprints at the ridge, where the body was found.
Trained soldiers, Molly. This campus taught them to cover their tracks.
No.
They caught up with her here, and then, after she'd collapsed, they carried her up there.
She was certain to be found. Why?
I don't know.
And why risk it for time, the possibility of being seen?
I don't know.
They're trained officers. Surely they'd leave her here, or better, they'd cover the body or throw her into the stream at the bottom.
So why didn't they?
You and Mr. Hardcastle don't seem so sure.
Of what?
Of what happened.
Oh, and you do.
Can we do it again sometime? Go out, I mean. Dancing.
It was a mistake. I'm sorry.
You were the first woman I ever...
The first.
You know, the girls in my neighborhood go to church every day, twice on Sundays. They have chaperones. First and only time they have sex is with their husbands.
What are you saying?
Oh, damn it, I'm sorry.
No!
Please! I just want to see you again. Is that so bad?
Oh, here you are.
I was just leaving.
Please. Tomorrow night.
No.
The club where we danced. I'll meet you outside.
I can't.
I'll be there from 8.
I won't be there.
I'll wait all night if I have to.
I think he likes you.
Can we go now?
He signed a confession.
Ferron?
Yes, and Colonel Allen won't let me speak with him.
Why do you want to?
Something's not right, Molly.
Can you ask the Chief Inspector?
No, he doesn't want to cause an international incident.
What did Ferron say?
I don't know. He's in court tomorrow.
So soon?
Preliminary hearing. Guildford.
What can you do?
Mr. Hardcastle, I hope you'll both be staying for lunch.
Thank you, Colonel.
Hungry.
The jailer, Mr. Davis, over at Guildford.
About
him? He makes a very fine cup of tea. Molly?
Yes.
I want you to put a call into that editor friend of yours.
Mr. McNabb.
Now, if you would.
He'll be at lunch.
The Rose and Crown was bombed out, wasn't it?
I was there and he killed me.
Well, call him at whatever pub he now spends his profits in. And please, it won't wait.
Hello?
Molly.
Yes?
Did I wake you?
What time is it?
Just gone 6.
Morning?
At night, Molly.
I fell asleep.
You sound awful. I've managed to speak to the clerk of the court over in Guildford. Mr. Davis is expecting you before 2. The preliminary hearing's down for 2:15.
Thank you.
I've got some news for you regarding Hardcastle.
Have you? What is it?
It's not something for the telephone.
Do you stay up here, even if there's an air raid?
They fly so low you can see the pilots' faces. Boys, frightened boys. You're shivering.
It's cold out here.
Have my jacket.
Thank you.
What did Mr. Hardcastle tell you exactly?
That his wife was found in the bath, apparently drowned. That it looked like suicide, but he was sure that wasn't the case.
Did he mention a half-empty whiskey bottle on the floor of the bathroom?
No.
But she was reading a collection of poems by Wilfred Owen.
The war poet?
Dulce et decorum est.
That's not proof of anything. I love those poems. I also drink whiskey when I can afford it.
Me too.
Who have you been speaking to?
The sergeant who found the body.
Was there a note?
His wife was an illustrator, an artist.
I think so. Yes, yes.
Up in Scotland to paint the mountains and the lakes, the heather of the beautiful country.
That's right.
The canvases she took with her were all empty.
Maybe she wasn't inspired.
She'd cut through them all with a razor blade.
Did Hardcastle see all this?
Not only did he see, but he was asked if he wanted to examine the body of his wife, which is certainly not usual, not just because he's the husband, but also he has no authority in a Scottish court.
And he said no?
He said no. He identified her, but declined to examine her.
Maybe he couldn't face it. I mean, what a thing to have to do.
He would have discovered that it wasn't murder or foul play, nor was it an accident. She drank the whiskey, got in the bath, and closed her eyes.
He told me.
Maybe he doesn't understand why. Maybe he doesn't want to.
His children blame him completely.
He probably blames himself. I know I would.
His wife was a Catholic.
There was a Bible in the bedroom, her own. Pages ripped out, whole passages scribbled over.
God. She must have been desperate.
Up there, by herself, trying to make sense of things.
Her family, her children.
I loved my son more than life itself. But what world did I bring him into? I would have given my life if I thought he would have been spared.
We see a lot of suicides. Sometimes I think it's like an epidemic. Men, women, children, all ages, all professions, but most of the time the coroner records them as deaths by misadventure.
The secret victims of war.
No wonder he's driving himself like this.
You just make sure that if he goes under, you don't fall with him.
Here we are, Mr. Hardcastle. Molly, welcome, both of you.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. This is most generous.
I always imagined the jailer's room to be bigger.
Well, it can certainly get crowded down here, miss.
I was telling Molly your teas are famous.
Oh, not up to what they were before the war.
Mr. Farron, will you have some tea with us?
Am I permitted?
Oh, I'm sure your warders won't mind, Mr. Davis.
I'll get another cup.
Thank you.
It's not going to be easy drinking with these bracelets on.
I don't think we can take them off.
No, guess not.
Did you box professionally, Mr. Farron?
I fought the Olympic Games.
In Berlin?
I got beat by a Brit.
I thought I knew your name. You were beaten by Johnny Harrison.
A good fighter.
From Hackney.
Did you meet Jesse Owens?
Sure, I met him.
What was he like?
Skinny. Do you have coffee?
No, I'm sorry, just tea.
Mrs. B brought home some acorn coffee the other day.
What's that?
Coffee made from acorns.
Well, you're kidding me, you drink acorns?
It's disgusting.
Mr. Farron, why have you confessed to killing Florence Green? Why have you confessed to killing Florence Green?
We had a fight. She'd been going with other men.
She told you that?
That's what I heard.
Did she tell you that she was pregnant?
Well, I said it wasn't mine. I kicked her out.
You were alone?
They say she had a heart attack. I must have frightened her. I didn't mean to.
Did you run down into the gully?
Well, hell no. I wanted nothing more to do with her.
How do I know you're telling the truth?
You don't, but what have I got to lose?
I need to know. And I need to know now.
I'd save your breath, sir.
What's that tattoo on your arm? Forget not the sorrows of this world.
It was her favorite prayer.
You loved Florence, didn't you?
Well, did you?
Florence is like an angel from God, you know. Reading these sections of the Bible, saying prayers to me, almost forgiving me. My words, my spitting, the holes in my socks. She thought she was Mary Magdalene, you know. That's what she was saying. She said she'd slept with Jesus. Yeah. I loved Florence, and I thought she loved me.
And you lived in a wigwam?
Sure. When we could. When no one else could see it. A place to sit, smoke. Me and Florence. Nothing else, no war, no people. Where I come from, guys like me ain't allowed to touch a white girl, you know? Some of the colored boys in my unit can't believe the freedom they have in this country. And a lot of the white boys don't like it.
I think we should be getting you into court now.
There's no way this can reach a full trial.
I was told there wouldn't be any kind of trial.
Well, for murder?
I was promised a court-martial.
Who by? Colonel Allen?
Well, at the trial they find me guilty and hang me, right?
That will depend on the evidence and the plea. Plead not guilty. Leave the evidence to me. There won't be a jury in the land who'll convict you.
Sir, You know, I used to think that whenever I stepped into a ring that the best fighter came out on top. That the judges would see. But that ain't the way of it. When I fought Johnny Harrison, all the evidence showed I was a clear winner. As then is now, I ain't going to be getting no medal around my neck.
We really must be moving on, sir.
Mr. Ferron.
Yes, sir.
Please.
You really need this case cleared, don't you, sir?
Yes, I do.
May I ask why?
Forget not the sorrows of this world.
Okay. I plead not guilty.
Good. Damn good.
Molly! I didn't think you'd come.
So why did you wait?
Well, I was hoping I was wrong.
Ferron did not kill Florence Green, did he? Did he?
That's not for me to say.
You know he didn't. That's right. See no evil, speak no evil.
Molly...
Three, or was it four, officers saw Florence walking by herself. They hated Ferron for having her. They came out of the mess, gave chase, wanted to frighten her. She ran. Where could she go? She ran through the gully in the hope of going back up the ridge to get back to Ferron, but they caught her. And she was so frightened. Who knows what they were saying, what they were threatening. Ferron called her an angel. Did you know that? An angel. I don't think they meant to kill her, no. They wanted to get back at Ferron. Too scared of him to confront him face to face. But poor Florence's heart couldn't take it, and she was dead. So what do? Take the body up onto the ridge. Why did they do that? To incriminate Ferron, perhaps. So they could cover their tracks more easily. And they were chasing him in the woods. What for? And why me? I don't know.
No, you don't.
And were you one of those officers?
No, I wasn't.
No?
No.
Private Ferron has pleaded not guilty.
I know he has. And believe me, I hope they clear him.
Though you doubt it.
Do you think I have no feelings of my own on this matter? If it's any consolation, four officers have been assigned for a secret mission that will take them behind enemy lines.
Consolation? For what?
They will almost certainly not be coming back.
Is that American justice?
This is not about justice, Molly. This is about trying to satisfy everyone and satisfying no one. This is for the people back home. For the generals and the politicians and the deals that have to be made. We are doing the best we can.
Well, Private Ferron is going one better. He won't be convicted.
We don't want to be here, Molly. It's not our war.
Hello?
Molly?
Mr. McNabb.
What's this about Private Ferron?
He's pleaded not guilty. We're so grateful for all your help. Hardcastle is confident of complete success.
Have you not heard?
No, what?
Private Ferron was found dead earlier this evening in his cell. He'd hanged himself.
No.
Oh, I'm an idiot. I thought you would have been told.
No.
Molly? Molly?
Did you know I was here?
An educated guess.
My old treehouse.
Yes. You built that yourself?
Well, my father did most of it. The flooring onto the branches.
Is it safe?
It used to be.
How did you get up there?
We climbed. We used to have a rope.
I've not climbed a tree in over 30 years. Are you sure it's safe?
Well, you can look at the view.
Yes, wonderful. Your own secret place.
Like Ferron's wigwam.
I know.
Your house in Scotland.
Yes, the cottage.
I have a confession.
I don't want to hear it, Molly.
I asked Mr. McNabb to help me find out about what happened to your wife.
And what juicy story did McNabb come up with?
Nothing.
That it was me who killed her?
No.
That she was seeing another man?
No.
I was waiting for the papers to start running a story. Dragging my name and Elizabeth's name.
No, that's ridiculous.
I used to think this naivety of yours so charming.
You were allowed to examine the body.
Oh, thank you very much.
I just wanted to help.
Don't you always, Molly, eh? The great purveyor of truth, of what's right and proper. Elizabeth was 38 years old. She was the youngest of five children, four older brothers, all of them, Angus, Stephen, William and George, her father, his brother, three of her cousins, all of them killed in the Great War. She saw them leave. She waved them off one by one. But not one of them returned. In the town where she lived, over half the population didn't come home. There's a great bloody stone monument sitting proud on the hill for all the world to see. The war to end all wars, lest we forget. And we did forget. I told Elizabeth that Hitler was just a jumped-up bully marching up to the top of the hill. But when Elizabeth saw that first uniform, those proud, swaggering boys, when she saw the sandbags, when she heard the first siren, I saw that she was breaking. That I had to get her out, anywhere, up to Scotland, as far away as possible. But what shall I do when we get there, she said. And I told her to paint what she saw, the beauty of the world. But what she saw was not beauty. What Elizabeth saw... I should have been there. I shouldn't have left her alone, not for 1 minute. Until the war was over, if it ever will be. I too have a confession. I don't want this to be your last case, Molly. I don't think I can do it without you. In fact, I know I can't. It's very beautiful here, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Makes it almost impossible to leave, to go back.
But go back we must, Mr. Hardcastle. We have no choice.
In the Wigwam murder, Mrs. P was played by Mary MacLeod, Molly, Emily Bruni, Hardcastle, Kevin Wakely, and Ferron by Joseph May. Chief Inspector Webb and Davis were played by John Hartley, Colonel Allen, William Roberts, Captain Richardson, Stuart Milligan, and McNabb, the editor, by Jonathan Hackett. Other parts were played by members of the cast. The Wigwam Murder was written by Michael Crompton and inspired by Molly Lefebvre's book, Murder on the Home Front. It was directed by John Dove.
The Mad Hatter Mystery by John Dixon Carr, the newspapers dubbed the thief the Mad Hatter, and his outrageous pranks amused all London. But the laughter turned to horror when a corpse with a crossbow through the heart was found at the Tower of London in a top hat. As Dr. Gideon Fell was to discover, the whole case turned on the matter of hats, in fact, threatened to become a nightmare of hats. For the victim was none other than Sir William Bitton's nephew, dressed in a golfing suit and wearing Sir William's stolen opera hat. And tying Sir William to his murdered nephew with a scarlet thread was the stolen manuscript of a completely unknown story said to be the handiwork of Edgar Allan Poe. In a tale as freighted with menace as the Traitor's Gate, portly Dr. Fell unravels a crime unique by even his standards of the bizarre.
Forgive me. Am I addressing Dr. Fell?
Dr. Livingston, I presume. No, I'm sorry. Sir William Batten. I'm delighted to meet you.
How do you do? We have a mutual acquaintance in Chief Superintendent Hadley. Oh, perhaps he's been delayed.
No, he's here. But the landlord just called him away to the telephone. Yeah, do sit down. Let me move that newspaper.
Ah, lunchtime edition. The Mad Hatter strikes again by our special correspondent, Philip Driscoll. You'd think they'd find something better for the front page.
Yes, well, I've been out of town for a few weeks, so I rather lost touch. But Hadley's put me in the picture. I gather Mr. Driscoll is your nephew.
Unfortunately, yes. He started writing about some lunatic who goes around snatching hats from the heads of law-abiding citizens. Seems to have become the latest sensation.
A policeman's helmet found on a costermonger's donkey. A judge's wig on a lamppost. A series of practical jokes, obviously.
I'm afraid I don't see the funny side of it. Last Saturday, this maniac stole my top hat as I was on my way to a meeting in the city. And this morning, as I was getting into my car, he stole my grey Homburg as well.
And such inclement weather, too. You might get a nasty head cold. But I understand you also suffered a more serious loss.
Ah, the stolen manuscript. Well, that's unique. Irreplaceable. An unpublished story by Edgar Allan Poe in the great man's own handwriting.
Sorry to have kept you waiting. I see you've introduced yourselves. Sir William, let me get you a drink. A whiskey, perhaps?
No, nothing, thank you.
Are you sure? I don't know quite how to tell you this, but...
What's wrong?
Sir William, you must prepare yourself for a shock. It's about your nephew.
Oh, I knew it. It's those damn practical jokes.
What began as a joke is no longer a laughing matter. The boy is dead. We have reason to believe that he was murdered.
Oh, no. Surely not.
His body has been found at the Tower of London at the foot of the steps by the Traitor's Gate. And on his head, someone had placed your stolen top hat.
We present Donald Sinden as Dr. Gideon Fell in The Mad Hatter Mystery by John Dixon Carr.
Notes made by me, Gideon Fell, on October the 10th, 1936, concerning the murder at the Tower of London. The news of the tragedy was bad enough, but that finishing touch made it particularly hideous. Hadley drove us to the Tower, not as fast as he would have liked, for a thick mist was rolling in off the river and visibility was poor. I encouraged Sir William to talk. I thought it might help. Perhaps you could tell me about the missing manuscript. An unpublished tale by Edgar Allan Poe must be quite a rarity. May I ask how you acquired it?
I was in Philadelphia, and I wanted to visit the house where Poe had lived as a young man. When I got there, I discovered the building was being demolished, but the workmen let me in to look round, and as they pulled out an old cupboard, they found a flimsy packet of papers behind it. One glance at the handwriting was enough. The men weren't interested, so I said I'd like to have it as a souvenir, and I gave them $10. Well, they were quite happy with that.
Now, what did you do with your acquisition?
I had it authenticated by Craig Roberts, one of the world's leading authorities on Poe. I told him I'd no intention of selling it, and brought it back to London, and kept it in my dressing room. Why, I thought it'd be perfectly safe.
But it wasn't. When did it disappear?
Sometime between Saturday afternoon and Sunday morning. There was no sign of anybody breaking in.
Did any members of your family know about the manuscript?
Well, yes, but naturally, I couldn't possibly suspect any of them.
Oh, naturally. But all the same, just to clear them of any possible suspicion.
At present, the household consists of my daughter Sheila, my brother Lester, and Laura, his wife. Philip had his own flat in Tavistock Court. It's a modern block off Tavistock Square. Though he usually joined us for Sunday lunch. Well, that's all. Apart from an American guest who was staying with us, Mr. Julius Arbor.
Oh.
He's a collector, like myself, with a special interest in Poe first edition.
What did you tell Mr. Arbor about the manuscript?
Well, no. I intended to show it to him, but somehow the opportunity never presented itself.
And there was no one else in the household who might have shared your interest in Poe?
Oh, certainly not. When I discovered the manuscript had gone, at first I admit I was a little suspicious of my manservant, Henry Marsh.
Oh, why was that?
Well, he's only been with me a few months. When I questioned him, he became nervous and flustered, but I put that down to his natural stupidity. He'd never even heard of Edgar Allan Poe.
Damn fool! Stepping off the pavement without looking and in a fog like this.
Sure. It was fairly murky this morning when I came out of the house. Which is why I didn't get a proper look at the brute who took my Homburg.
Ah, the Homburg is... Now, how did that happen exactly?
Well, I thought it was a sneak thief trying to break into my car. But when I went up to him, he just grabbed my hat and ran off before I could stop him. Oh, well, never mind that. I keep thinking about Philip. I was fond of the boy, but perhaps I was too strict with him. I kept him on a tight allowance. He had no idea of the value of money. I paid the rent for his flat, and I made a point of going round there regularly, on the first Tuesday of every month, just to keep an eye on the place and make sure he wasn't getting into mischief. Well, now I shan't have to do that anymore.
Here we are, Tower Hill, and the gate's open.
We passed through the gateway and were stopped by the guards on duty. When we got out of the car, a human warder was waiting for us.
Superintendent Hadley?
Yes. Who's in charge here?
The deputy governor, General Mason. He discovered the body.
Mason? Thank God. He's a friend of mine.
If I might have your name, sir.
This is Sir William Batten and my colleague, Dr. Fell.
Very good, sir. Come this way, please, General.
He led us through the precincts of the tower, over a stone bridge across the moat. Beneath an archway, opposite the stone steps leading down to Traitor's Gate, General Mason met us.
Good God, Batten, but how on earth... I was going to ring you and break the news as soon as I'd spoken to the superintendent, but...
Never mind. This is Superintendent Hadley, yes. Dr. Gideon Fell, General Mason. So, where's the boy? I want to see him.
He's where I found him. We couldn't disturb the body until the police arrived.
Just tell me, what killed him?
It appears to be the bolt of a crossbow. It's about 4 inches sticking out of his chest, straight through the heart. Instant death, no pain whatever.
Were there many people here today?
No, not many. That's on account of the weather. If you'd just come down the steps with me, Superintendent, I've got a flashlight. Perhaps you'd wait here, gentlemen. If you look over the rail, I think you'll be able to see for yourselves.
Philip Driscoll lay at the bottom of the steps, as if he had rolled down them. In the torchlight, we saw the gleam of steel projecting from his chest. The top hat on his head was much too large, coming down almost to his eyes and flattening his ears. It was a grotesque spectacle, and obviously distressing for Sir William. So General Mason escorted the old man into the building before rejoining us under the archway.
Sorry to keep you waiting. No doubt you'll need me to answer some questions.
Yes, sir. When exactly did Driscoll arrive, do we know?
Somewhere about 1:20, I gather. I wasn't here. Dalry, my secretary, picked me up from the middle of town in my car, and we got back here at 2:30. We came in this way, along Water Lane. Dalry let me out at the gate of the Bloody Tower, and then he drove back to put the car away. I was going to my own quarters when I remembered something that I had to do. So I came back here, and as I passed these steps, I glanced down. I couldn't see very clearly, but I could tell something was wrong, so I went down and found him. Minutes later, Dalry returned from the garage and I called him. I told him who it was. Well, he and Driscoll were old friends. In fact, Dalry's unofficially engaged to Sheila Batten, Sir William's daughter. You'll hear about that. I told him to fetch the doctor, but of course it was useless.
And when the doctor examined the body?
He said that Driscoll had been dead at least 3/4 of an hour. Possibly longer.
Forgive me, but you appear to have identified the young man immediately. How was that?
Well, as I say, he and Dalry were close friends. Driscoll was always popping in and out. We all knew him.
I see. One more question. About the crossbow bolt. They're not exactly common or garden weapons. Did it come from the collection here?
I can't tell you, but the armory will know.
It was pretty bleak under that archway. So the General suggested that we should go into the Warder's Hall at the Bywood Tower to join Sir William. We sat and warmed ourselves by the log fire for some time until his secretary came and found us.
Superintendent Hadley?
Yes.
The General asked me to tell you that... Oh, Sir William. I'm so sorry. I don't know what to say.
Yeah, that's all right, Robert. Thank you.
Now, what did I... Oh, yes. The armory could see at a glance the crossbow bolt isn't a genuine weapon. It's a modern copy. But they'll be able to tell us more once the police surgeon has... Well, you know.
Yes, yes, of course.
Oh, and another thing. There weren't many visitors here because of the fog. After they'd been questioned and their details had been taken, most of them were sent home. But there are still 2 people the General thought you might want to see. One is Mrs. Lester Batten.
What the devil is my sister-in-law doing here? Does she know about Philip?
Yes, I told her. She was very upset.
And I told her you'd arrived, Sir William.
And the other visitor?
An American gentleman, Mr. Julius Arbour.
Now, that's interesting. Very interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, Mr. Dollery, I understand you and Mr. Driscoll were close friends.
Ever since our school days. In a way, he seemed to rely on me. He often turned to me when he had problems.
What sort of problems?
Financial, mostly. Nothing serious. But he sometimes ran up bills he couldn't pay.
Oh, he did he?
Sorry, I shouldn't have said.
But nothing serious, nothing that might be considered a motive for murder.
Oh, no, nothing like that. I mean, only this morning he...
Yes. What brought him here this morning?
He rang up very early. I live in, you see. I've got a room upstairs. But this morning I was a bit late coming down, and when I walked into the office, Parker, one of the warders, was on the phone.
Hang on, sir. He's here now. Just come in this minute. Mr. Driscoll for you.
Hello, Phil. You're bright and early. Oh. What's wrong? Well, if you think I can help, can't you tell me what it's about? All right, then. Yes, I'll be here at lunchtime. Drop in about 1 o'clock and we'll see if we can sort it out, whatever it is. See you later.
Will you be here at lunchtime, sir? Wasn't there something about the General's car?
Oh, yes, damn it. The electric horn isn't working. I've got to take it along to Holborn and get it fixed. But I can leave that till after lunch.
Did you say Holborn? I mean, there must be a garage nearer than that, surely.
Yes, but this particular garage is run by an ex-soldier from the General's old regiment. Anyway, I didn't think much more about it until about 1:45, when I was waiting for Phil to arrive. And then...
Oh, sorry to disturb you, Mr. Dowry, but... Oh, I thought you were on the phone.
I was. I only just rang off.
Well, there's a call for you on the other line. Mr. Driscoll wants to speak to you.
I thought he was coming here at 1:00.
Seems like there's been a change of plan. Anyway, he's holding on.
Oh, well, I'd better see what he wants.
And what did he want?
He sounded rather strange. He said he couldn't come to the tower, so I'd got to go to the flat and meet him there. He said it was a matter of life and death.
Didn't he give you any sort of explanation?
No. I said, I thought you were doing so well, following up the Mad Hatter story. And he said, I followed it too far, and now it's got me.
What did you do?
Well, I had to take the car to Holborn anyway, so I drove there and left it at the garage, saying I'd pick it up later. It's only a short walk to the flat. I rang the bell a couple of times, and then I walked in.
Wait, he left the door open?
No, I've got a spare key. You see, the gates here close at 10 sharp every night. Nobody goes in or out after that. So if I'm out for the evening, Phil lets me doss down in his sitting room. I mean, he used to. Anyway, I went in, but he wasn't there. So I sat down and waited. Now we come to the strange part. I still can't explain this.
Now go on.
According to Parker, about 10 minutes after I left, Phil turned up and asked for me. When he told him I'd gone to the flat, Parker said he went white as a sheet. He said he'd rung first thing and arranged to meet me at 1, but he never changed the appointment. He didn't make the second phone call.
But you spoke to him yourself.
Well, yes. At least I thought so. Oh, Parker, the very man.
Beg pardon, sir, but...
I was telling him about the second phone call. You thought it was Mr. Driscoll too, didn't you?
To the best of my knowledge, it was. But since he turned up later, I suppose it can't have been.
And you told him about the second phone call?
Yes. He used some very strong language. Very put out he was. When I suggested he should go back to the flat, he said, no, when he finds no one there, he'll come back. I'll stay here and wait for him. Well, he was a bundle of nerves.
How do you mean?
Well, he couldn't sit still. Presently, he said, I'm going for a walk. And out he went. By then, it was nearly 1:30, so I thought I'd better phone Mr. Dowry. I had the number of the flat, so I rang and told him what had happened, and he said he'd come back right away. And I looked out of the window. I wanted to tell Mr. Driscoll, but he was walking towards the Traitor's Gate. He went under the archway, and that's when this other person reached out and touched his arm.
What other person?
Male or female?
I couldn't tell you. They were in the shadows. But someone reached out, and he turned towards whoever it was. Then they sort of disappeared in the fog.
I see. Well, thank you. You've been very helpful.
Yeah, before you go, I had the impression that you originally came in to tell us something.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. The General's compliments. He asked if you're ready to see Mrs. Batten and Mr. Arbour.
Well, Mrs. Batten, certainly. I think we'll keep Mr. Arbour waiting a little longer.
Excellent. That won't do him any harm.
Very well, sir. I'll fetch the lady right away.
The police surgeon sent us the murder weapon. Along the side of the bolt, a single word was engraved, and the word, horribly apt, was carcass. We were still examining it when General Mason brought in Laura Batten. Hatley tried to cover it up, but it was too late.
Superintendent, this is Mrs. Batten.
Oh, goodness! How on earth does that get here?
You mean you recognize it?
Of course, it belongs to me. My husband and I bought it when we were on a walking holiday in France. They sell them as souvenirs. Well, you can see it says Carcassonne on the... Uh-huh. Oh, somebody's been tampering with it.
Yes, the pointed end has been filed down. Was it always as sharp as this?
Oh, my God. Is that what... Is that how he...
My dear, we must try to deal with this calmly and sensibly. This is Chief Superintendent Hadley and his colleague, Dr. Gideon Fell.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Please, sit down, Mrs. Batten.
Oh, thank you.
Now, let me get one thing clear, Sir William. If this souvenir was kept in your house, I presume you've seen it before.
Not that I remember. Wait, Laura, you went to France while I was in America. I suppose that must be... That's why
Are you all right?
Yes, it's just a... Suddenly I feel rather tired. So much has happened.
Of course. I think it would be better if you went home and tried to get some rest.
Let me take you up to my quarters. I'll give you a brandy. I have a fascinating collection of letters on my desk concerning Walter Raleigh's imprisonment. I'm sure they'll interest you.
As the two men left, I saw a look of horror on Laura Batten's face, as if she'd suddenly thought of something that terrified her. But she pulled herself together as she turned to face Hadley.
So, it's true then. Even when Rob told me he was dead, I couldn't believe it.
Rob?
Rob Dowry. It's been a terrible shock for him, for all of us. But I don't understand why I had to be questioned, as if... You don't imagine I had anything to do with Phil's death, do you?
I have to question anyone who might have been in the vicinity at the time of his death.
And when did it happen, exactly?
Well, according to the surgeon's report, sometime between 1:30 and 1:45. Can you tell us where you were then?
Oh, I'd been wandering around. I was probably admiring the crown jewels. I often come here. Not so much for the history as the exercise. Walking is so good for the figure. You should try it, Doctor.
Thank you. Yes, I'll bear it in mind. And did you happen to see Mr. Driscoll during your walk?
Of course not. I didn't even know he was here.
I see. Well, I don't think we need to detain you any longer. I'm sure you're anxious to get home. And as Mr. Arbour is waiting...
Yes, I saw him. What's he doing here? I wish William had never invited him to the house. He's a ghastly creature and a terrible liar. You can't believe a word he says. Well, don't say I didn't warn you. Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Well, what did you make of her?
She is an old hand at evading questions. Very frightened. I saw her face just before the general left. Something he said terrified her. I don't know why.
I missed that. Look, I've got to go and check the statements from the other visitors. I think I'll leave you to deal with the devious Mr. Arbour. You can pretend to be me.
What? Now,
he's probably a complete waste of time, but you might as well put him through the ringer.
I'll do nothing of the sort. I refuse to participate in such...
Listen here, I don't know what's going on, but I've been put to a whole lot of inconvenience this afternoon.
I'm sorry, Mr. Arbour. The Chief Superintendent will see you now. Carry on, Chief.
Apparently, you're in charge of this investigation.
Yes, apparently, I am. Yes. Please, sit down.
Oh, thanks. Of course, I'll be happy to assist if I can. What do you want to ask me?
Well, how about, have you read any good Edgar Allan Poe manuscripts lately?
What? I thought you were here to investigate some sort of murder.
Yes, also a missing document. Perhaps you might find that more interesting.
If you're referring to the theft of a certain manuscript taken from Sir William Batten...
Ah, so you know about that. I thought you might.
And he thinks I'm the guilty party. Believe me, I'm not insulted, but I thought it wiser to move out of Sir William's house this morning. I've made arrangements to stay with an acquaintance in Golders Green. I'm sure you'll understand.
Yes, what I don't understand is how you knew that manuscript existed. Sir William told me he never mentioned it to you.
Oh, that is true, but he's like a child. He couldn't resist dropping hints. So I took the precaution of checking with an old friend back home, Craig Roberts, who told me he had seen it, and it was undoubtedly authentic. So I decided to buy it.
But Sir William had no intention of selling it.
Oh, he had no right to it. Okay, he paid a few dollars to some workman, but it wasn't theirs to sell. In law, it belonged to the owner of the derelict property, so I called that guy and offered him $10,000, and he agreed. The whole transaction was perfectly legal.
Not if it involved murder.
Murder? But there's no connection. I mean, I know a man's been killed, but that's got nothing to do with the manuscript.
You mean you don't know who the man was? He was Sir William Batten's nephew, Philip Driscoll.
Oh, my God. I had no idea.
I expect you met him at Sir William's house.
Yes, I did, briefly. He came to lunch the Sunday before last. Oh, that's just terrible.
Terrible, indeed. Well, perhaps you could explain what brought you here to the Tower at lunchtime today.
Well, I'd heard they had some interesting letters about Walter Rowley, and I was hoping to see them, but they weren't on show. I was just on my way out when I almost ran into a young couple in the fog, a man and a woman. I thought his voice was vaguely familiar. You mean that was Driscoll?
Can you remember what he said?
Just let me think. He said that they were in a real mess, and something about his uncle getting to hear of it. Then he suddenly said, "Oh, hell, I forgot." There was something he had to do. He said he'd be as quick as he could, and he told her to go take a look at the crown jewels, and that he'd catch up with her later. Then he dashed off, and she walked past me. I couldn't see her face because she had her head down, but I remember the coat she was wearing. Do you know, I saw it again just now, coming through that door. Laura Batten was wearing it.
And what time would this have been?
About a quarter after one.
Thank you. One last question, if I may. Your valuable manuscript has vanished, but you don't seem interested in finding it. Since you claim it your property, why haven't you reported it to the police?
Oh, I didn't want to trouble the police, but I've not been idle, I promise you. Let's just say I've been following up certain leads which are, forgive me, not open to you. Good day. Oh, I beg your pardon.
Don't mention it. Well, how did it go, Chief Superintendent?
Don't give me any more witnesses like Mr. Arbour. But it knocked him for six when he found out who the murder victim was.
He didn't know?
Not until I told him. I'm sure he didn't steal that manuscript. He's still desperate to get his paws on it. But he might have hired someone else to steal it for him.
Of course, Driscoll. We know he was often strapped for cash, so if Arbour was prepared to pay him enough...
No. You can accuse anyone else. But I beg you, do not for one moment accuse Driscoll.
Why not?
I don't imagine he made much as a freelance reporter. He practically lived on his uncle's charity. And I dare say he figures handsomely in the old boy's will. Do you really believe he'd have risked all that to steal his uncle's prized possession? Now, look here. I refuse to discuss this wretched business anymore. It's nearly six. I need a drink. But I'll leave you with a couple of hints.
What sort of hints?
One, Driscoll was last seen alive at the Traitor's Gate at 1:15. He rushed off to another part of the building and returned to the same spot, where he died between 1:30 and 1:45. So where did he go during those missing minutes? And my other hint, since Driscoll's head was more or less the same size as his uncle's, where was Sir William's hat? Far too big for him. Think on these things, my dear chap. See you later.
Thank you very much. Ah, I thought I might find you here.
What's happened? Not another fatality, I trust.
No, but a couple of interesting developments. I sent a man round to Tavistock Court, and he arrived just in time to see someone, possibly a woman, leaving Driscoll's flat. The front door had been forced open, probably with a chisel. Someone had turned the flat over, searching for heaven knows what. He put in a report, but it doesn't tell us much, though he mentions one rather curious detail. Two cheap plaster figures on the mantelpiece, labelled Philip II and Mary Tudor.
Ah, I know two things about Queen Mary. One, she was passionately in love with Philip II of Spain. And two, she's generally known as Bloody Mary.
So if Philip represents Philip Driscoll, who the devil is Mary?
Did you notice the initials on Laura Batten's handbag? L.M.B. I wonder what the M stood for. Oh, well. Now, what was the other interesting development?
When our friend Alba left the tower, he picked up a cab. But his behaviour was so strange that after the cabbie dropped him at Golders Green, he went straight on to Scotland Yard. He said Alba was in a terrible state, shaking with fear and mumbling something about a voice.
That voice. His voice. He's still here, coming after me.
Beg pardon, sir?
It was his voice, you see. Now tell me something. Do you carry a revolver?
Why would I want a thing like that?
But we're not safe. It was his voice. Are we being followed?
No, sir. The road here is perfectly clear.
Oh, good. Good. But he can still find us. Hey, listen. That address I gave you in Golders Green, I want you to drop me off before that, a couple of streets away, to be on the safe side. So the voice will never know.
The cabbie obeyed orders, but he remembered the original address. I had the house checked. It's rented by an American couple. I've sent a man there to stay out of sight and keep watch.
I think you should tell your man to make himself as conspicuous as possible.
Eh? Well, what's the point of that?
If Arbor sees he's being watched, he'll be so terrified he might even tell us what he knows. But before that, if I may, I'd rather like to take a look at Philip Driscoll's flat.
That's the one, the last door on the left. You see that crack of light? It's still ajar. My chap must have left it switched on.
Not necessarily.
What the... Come on!
We found a man, tall and heavily built, standing before the fireplace. On the mantelpiece was a gaudy statuette, a woman in mock Tudor dress, and the grate was littered with fragments of plaster, the remains of a companion piece. As the man looked up, we saw his face in the mirror.
Good evening, Mr. Lester Batten.
Yes. Who the hell are you?
My name is Hadley. I'm from Scotland Yard. This is Dr. Gideon Fell. We had to question your wife earlier in connection with the death of your nephew.
Yes, the young swine's dead. She told me when I got home.
I'd intended to call on you later this evening. I'm afraid we have to ask you some questions, too.
Yeah, perhaps you could carry on without me. There are a couple of things I'm looking for. In another room, I expect. As a journalist, Mr. Driscoll must have had a desk and a typewriter somewhere. Will you excuse me?
Mr. Batten, I'm not interested in your marital problems, except insofar as they concern our investigations. We know that your nephew met Mrs. Batten today at the tower, and I have to ask, is it possible that they were having an affair?
That's a damned lie. How dare you
I'm not insinuating. I'm asking a question. Or had Philip already broken off the affair?
It's none of your business.
When they met today, he was a very worried man. Perhaps he was afraid Sir William might find out what was going on. Had he told your wife the affair was over? Is that why she followed him to the tower? In a desperate attempt to make him change his mind? And if that failed, we also know he was stabbed with a weapon that belonged to your wife. Can you imagine what a clever lawyer could make of that?
I'm not staying here to listen to any more of this. Get out of my way!
Leaving already, Mr. Batten?
suppose you heard all that.
Oh, yes. Though I have to say I don't agree with your theory. Laura Batten might have killed Driscoll, but you would never have stuck that top hat on his head.
Of course not, I realize that. But I was hoping that by casting suspicion on his wife, I might persuade Mr. Batten to come clean and tell us what he'd been up to.
I congratulate you. Very convincing performance. Pity it didn't work.
What have you got there?
A tool bag. I found it in the kitchen.
So that's what you were looking for? The chisel that was used to force open the front door?
Oh, hardly. You don't suppose somebody came in, found the chisel, and went out again in order to break the door down, do you? No, I was looking for this.
Hang on, this could be news of Mr. Arbour. Hadley? No, I am not the constable on duty. He left some time ago. I happen to be Chief Superintendent Hadley. Who is this? Sheila. Oh, Sheila Batten. Sir William's daughter. I beg your pardon? Oh, I see. Well, I suppose you could, but when do you want to come? Tonight?
But she's coming here tonight.
Her father's asked her to pick up some of Philip's belongings. Is there anyone there who could come with you? It's getting late and, sorry? Oh. She says Dowry's with her. He'll drive her over.
Well, let me speak to her. Hello, Miss Batten. Gideon Fell here. Please remind Mr. Dowry that he has a 10 o'clock curfew at the Tower. Perhaps you should bring someone else to see you home. How about Sir William's manservant? What's his name? Marsh. Of course, yes. Please bring him as well. I'd like to meet him. And I look forward to meeting you. Goodbye.
Well, what's brought this on? You're very keen on meeting people all of a sudden.
I've always enjoyed meeting people. I love the human race. Hadn't you noticed?
I'm sorry. May I, may I come in?
Ah, Mr. Batten.
I've changed my mind. I want to make a confession.
A confession? You mean you...
No, wait. Let him finish.
It's true. I did suspect that my wife and Philip were involved with one another. I've been employing a private detective to follow my wife and report on the meetings. So I have a witness who was shadowing Laura today at the Tower, someone who can swear that when she left Philip, he was alive and well. I'm not proud of my part in this, but I had to tell you. Where do we go from here?
I think you should go home. You've done things you're ashamed of, like the rest of us. But tonight you only smashed one plaster figure. Then you could have smashed two. You spoke up on your wife's behalf when you might have disowned her. So, go home, Mr. Batten.
Well, I'm still very fond of her, you see. Thank you, gentlemen. Good night.
Since there was no reason to doubt an independent witness, we removed Laura Batten from our list of suspects. But that still left us with many unanswered questions. Where did Driscoll go when he left her? Where did Julius Arbour fit in? And whose was the voice that terrified him out of his wits?
I'll tell you something we overlooked.
Now, may I tell you what you're thinking at this moment? You're saying to yourself, murderer, big man, very disturbed emotionally, man with access to crossbow bolt, man not even questioned about his whereabouts at the time of the murder.
Lester Batten, that's exactly what I...
Hello? The lock on the front door seems to be broken, so I let myself in. Rob, Mr. Dowry, is parking the car. I'm Sheila, Superintendent Hadley?
That's me, and this is Dr. Fell.
How do you...
Oh, what's happened to Mary Tudor? That was one of the things I wanted to take back with me.
You've seen these figures before, then?
Oh, yes. I was there when they got them at the fair on Hampstead Heath.
When who got them?
Phil and Laura and Uncle Lester. We all had to go on the rifle range. Uncle Lester's a very good shot.
Oh, really?
When he asked Laura to choose a prize, she picked out those figures. Uncle got quite cross and said he wouldn't have such rubbish in the house, so Phil said he'd like them. That's why I wanted them, to remind me of him. I'd even phoned Rob to ask him to persuade Phil to give them to me, but...
When did you telephone, Mr. Dowry?
Well, it was ages ago. I can't remember exactly, because I talk to Rob every morning. Either I ring him or he rings me. Phil used to tease me about it. Sometimes he'd ring me up pretending to be Rob and say silly things.
So, did you speak to Mr. Dowry this morning?
Of course.
Did he tell you Philip was going to meet him at the tower at lunchtime?
Yes, he said Phil had got himself into some sort of mess again.
Was this at breakfast time, by any chance, with the rest of the family sitting there listening?
Yes. When I rang off, Uncle Lester said he wanted to see Phil today as well. I don't know why. That's all it was. Nothing interesting.
Nothing interesting?
Sorry to keep you waiting. I was just parking the car. And what's wrong?
I was telling them about this morning. Uncle said he wanted to speak to Phil today, so if Phil was going to be at the tower at one, he'd go round to the flat during the morning. And he asked Daddy to let him have the key in case he was out and he could sit and wait for him.
Your father has a key to this flat?
Yes. He treats us like children. He paid Phil's rent and dropped in once a month to see what he was up to. So, Daddy gave Uncle the key and that was all. Anyway, I'm going to start packing up Phil's things.
Yeah, but before you go, my dear, you said you'd bring your father's manservant with you. Is he...
Henry? Oh, yes, he's waiting in the car.
He wasn't sure if you wanted him right away. Shall I go and fetch him?
Yes, please.
Oh, Rob, you are a dear. And when you get back, you can come and give me a hand with the packing.
A few minutes later, we were joined by Henry Marsh, who perched nervously on the edge of a chair.
My previous employer, sir? Oh, yes, certainly. I had the honour to work for Lord Sandyville.
Really? Until you left under a cloud, I suppose?
Oh, no, sir. I only left after his lordship passed away.
Another mysterious murder, perhaps?
Good gracious, no, sir. You ask Sir William. I'm sure he'd give me a very good reference.
Not if he knew what I know. Mr. Marsh, your sins have found you out.
Steady on, old man.
Confess now. You stole Sir William's manuscript.
Oh, sir, I didn't mean to. I didn't know what it was. And when I found out, it was too late.
Shall I tell you what you did? Sir William had purchased two new hats recently. A Homburg and a Topper. No doubt he'd tried them on in the shop and ordered them to be sent. But on Saturday night, when you were laying out his evening clothes, you found they'd sent him a top hat that was much too big.
But that's right. How did you find out?
You knew Sir William had a quick temper. He might blame you for the mistake, so you stuffed the hat band with paper. A flimsy packet of papers you found in his desk. And next day you discovered what you'd done. That little bundle was worth a cool $10,000.
So the hat fitted him snugly that night, but when someone shoved it on Driscoll's head, it was much too big, because the papers had gone. Presumably whoever killed Driscoll stole them. Unless, of course...
Very well, yes, very well, Mr. Marsh. We won't keep you. I'm sure you'll feel better now you've made your confession.
Yes, but when you tell Sir William, he'll be very...
I don't think we need bother Sir William about it. He's got enough troubles already. Off you go, Mr. Marsh. I'm sure you'll sleep soundly tonight.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
As I was about to say before I was so rudely interrupted...
You were about to say, unless, of course, Philip Driscoll stole the manuscript himself. But as I keep telling you, Driscoll would never have upset his uncle like that. So you can imagine how he felt when he discovered he'd done the one thing in the world he didn't want to do.
I don't follow. I thought the Mad Hatter...
Don't you see? Philip Driscoll was the Mad Hatter. He was a struggling freelance, keen to make his name. He needed a front-page scoop, so he decided to create one. A policeman's helmet, a judge's wig, they all made good headlines. And I suspect his next little triumph would have been to steal the headgear of a yeoman warder and nail it to a door with a crossbow bolt to give it a neat historical touch.
Do you mean to say that...
Yes. He stole that bolt himself, probably during Sunday lunch. This is what I was looking for... The file he used to sharpen the point. And 24 hours later, it killed him.
But why did he steal two of Sir William's hats? It would hardly have been front page news the second time.
No, of course not. When he found the manuscript inside the top hat, he was appalled. And when Sir William told us about a thief breaking into his car, it was really Philip trying to return the manuscript. So he created a diversion by snatching the Homburg and running off into the fog.
Quick thinking. I'll say one thing for him. He was full of surprises.
While our young friends were busy, I took Hadley into the study. There was a heap of burnt paper in the grate. From the fragments we pieced together, it was clear that they were letters from Laura to Philip. That was why she looked so alarmed when General Mason mentioned some fascinating letters on his desk, and why she broke into the flat to destroy them. But underneath those letters, there were some very different fragments. Only a few words in faded sepia ink were legible, but I had no doubt whose hand had written them.
Edgar Allan Poe.
Another mystery story, and one which will never be solved, alas.
Now, that's got to be about Arbor. Hello? Yes, speaking. What? Oh. Right, I'll be there as soon as I can.
What's happened?
It's all over. I blame myself. I should have realized what a state he was in.
Oh, sorry. I thought it might have been for me. I didn't mean to barge in.
No, come in. Shut the door. I'm afraid there's some more bad news.
Lester Batten?
Yes. He went home and put a bullet through his brain.
Dear God.
Do you want to break it to Miss Batten, or would you like me to do it?
No, don't bother. I'll tell her. But I'd better not take her back there. She'd be terribly upset. Oh, wait. I know her best friend, a girl who lives in Park Lane. I'll get Margaret to put her up for the night, if that's all right.
As we were about to leave the flat, the telephone rang again. Hadley was informed that Mr. Julius Arbour wished to see him as soon as possible. We arranged to meet him at Sir William's house. When we arrived at Bloomsbury Square, Hadley rang the doorbell.
I'm not much good at quotations, but there's one that always stays in my mind. There's no refuge from confession but suicide. And suicide is confession.
A well-turned phrase, but not invariably true. Ah, somebody's coming. So we meet again, Mr. Marsh.
Yes, sir. Please come in, gentlemen. In this situation, sir, perhaps I should have called a doctor, but since Mr. Batten was dead...
No, you did the right thing. I take it you informed Sir William.
Well, sir, he was still very upset after what happened this morning. He'd taken a sleeping draught, and I didn't like to awaken him. I thought it might be better to let him sleep.
I see. When you heard the shot, you went up to Mr. Batten's room.
Oh, yes, sir. I found him, as you'll see, lying on his bed, fully dressed.
Where was Mrs. Batten?
In the next room. There's a communicating door. She came in a moment later.
All right. Let's go upstairs.
Lester Batten was still holding the Webley Scott service automatic in his right hand, but his face was curiously peaceful. I left Hadley to do what had to be done and knocked on the communicating door.
Come in, Dr. Fell. You know all about it, don't you? About Phil and me. I knew you'd find out.
You shouldn't have broken into his flat. You were seen.
I didn't break in. Phil had given me a key. But I took a chisel from his tool bag and broke the lock to make it look like a burglary.
Never mind it. Doesn't matter now.
No. Did you see what Lester had in his hand?
The gun?
No, the other hand. It was a snapshot. A photo of me. When I saw that, I stood there for a long time looking at him. Now, sitting by this window, looking into the darkness, I can see a thousand images. And they're all his. I cried today when Phil died, but I can't cry anymore. Because I know now I loved my husband. Just tell me, he killed Philip, didn't he?
Mrs. Batten, your husband loved you very much. Hold on to that thought.
It was only... his ideas were so different from mine, and I kept hurting him. If I sleep tonight, perhaps... perhaps tomorrow I'll be able to cry.
I went down to the library, where Mr. Arbour was waiting. I was about to explain that the superintendent was otherwise engaged, but I didn't get the chance.
Superintendent Hadley, I'm glad to see you.
Yes. Good evening, Mr. Arbour.
I've got to tell you the whole truth.
Yes, I think that might be a very wise move.
Just tell me, is Sir William around?
He's gone to bed, having an early night.
Did you tell him about my purchasing the rights to the manuscript legally?
No, I didn't. Well, there wasn't much point, since the manuscript no longer exists. It's just a pile of ashes. Look, I've brought you one little scrap as a souvenir.
What? This is an outrage. This was my property.
If I were you, I'd put that piece of paper away and say no more about it. You're in enough trouble as it is.
What do you mean by that?
Let's be frank. You wanted to get hold of that manuscript by fair means or foul, but you were afraid of Sir William. So you offered someone money to steal it on your behalf.
That is not true. I admit the idea did cross my mind, but that's as far as it went. Until last Sunday night, when I received a phone call from an unknown person. He wouldn't give his name, but even though I'd only met him once, I knew right away it was Philip Driscoll. He asked me how much I'd pay if he got hold of the manuscript and handed it over, no questions asked. So I named a rather large sum, and he agreed.
And what happened next?
And what happened next was he got killed. Well, I was in a quandary. I guessed he must have been murdered on account of stealing the manuscript, and I thought maybe I'd be involved as some kind of accessory.
But there was worse to come. When you left us this afternoon, you had a terrible fright and dashed back to Golders Green in a blind panic. Why was that?
Oh, when I left, I heard a voice speaking inside the tower, and it was the same voice. It was Driscoll's voice. But you just told me he was dead, and somehow he'd return to haunt me. You're laughing at me.
I'm not laughing, merely smiling. If that's all that's worrying you, let me assure you, you have no need to fear. The voice can't hurt you now. But if I were you, I'd return to America as soon as possible, before you land in any more trouble.
And then you packed him off with a flea in his ear. Good work, Chief Superintendent.
And the pleasure was all mine, believe me. And meanwhile, have you come to any conclusions?
Yes and no. Lester killed Driscoll. No one else had the means and the motive. He went to the tower where he witnessed Philip and Laura's last rendezvous. And when Philip left, he followed and...
Excuse me. May I speak to you for a moment?
No, go away. Don't say anything.
I'm sorry. I really
Look,
must...
Oh, don't backstab. Keep your mouth shut, for heaven's sake.
It's no good. I'm here to give myself up, Superintendent. I killed Philip Driscoll.
What? But...
I didn't mean to. It was an accident. I wasn't going to say anything, only you suspected Lester Batten. And then he killed himself, so I had to tell you the truth.
You young idiot. I've been trying to cover up for you all the evening.
Now, just a moment. Are you telling me you actually killed...
Not on purpose. He jumped at me, and in the fight... God knows, I didn't want to hurt him. I only wanted to steal that damn manuscript.
Wait, right there. Would you mind telling me how you managed to be in the flat in Holborn at 1:30 and kill Driscoll at the tower a few minutes later?
No. That's where we went wrong. Driscoll wasn't killed at the tower. He died in his own flat.
But that's impossible.
No, it's true. Why Phil came back to the flat, I still don't know. I was certain he'd be at the tower. He told me he'd hidden the manuscript in his flat. That's why I thought it would be safe to steal it.
You mean you knew he was the Mad Hatter?
Of course. He always asked me to help him. We'd even discussed his next trick. He was going to snaffle a hat from one of the yeoman warders.
Yes, well, never mind that. You also knew about the manuscript.
I told him to hang on to it, because I had a plan of my own. On Sunday night, I phoned Arbour and asked him how much he'd pay me if I stole the manuscript for him. I know it was rotten of me, but I was pretty desperate.
But Arbour said it was Driscoll who phoned him.
You overlooked something that Sheila Batten told us. She said Driscoll sometimes played jokes on her, ringing up and pretending to be Dullery. Their voices must have been very similar.
Which is why I was able to ring Parker, pretending I was Philip.
The mysterious second phone call.
Yeah.
Remember? You'd called the other line on your phone and spoken to Parker, telling him that you had just called, and asking to speak to yourself, as you told him. You just hung up when he walked in. It was an ingenious plan, and at first it all went like clockwork.
You see, I had to have money. Real money. Sheila and I want to get married. But Sir William's a very wealthy man, and I'm only a jumped-up clerk with no prospects. I knew he'd never accept me as a son-in-law unless I had cash in the bank. I realize now it was a crazy idea, but at the time... Well, like I said, I was desperate. I only had to leave the General's car at the Hoban garage, nip across to the flat, and get the manuscript. It took me quite a while to find it, and while I was searching, the phone rang, and I picked it up automatically. It was silly of me, but actually it gave me an alibi. It was Parker saying that Phil was at the tower. So I knew I had all the time in the world. Eventually, I ran the damn thing to earth. In the wardrobe, inside the pocket of one of his suits. And then...
And then?
I had it in my hands. Suddenly, I heard a sound. I turned round, and Phil was standing in the doorway, looking at me. He realized what I was going to do, and he went berserk. You never saw him in one of his rages. He was like a maniac. The crossbow bolt was on the table, and he snatched it up and charged at me. I tried to dodge, but I don't know how it happened. A chair overturned. We hit the floor together, and I was on top of him. There was a sort of dull crunch. And then...
Go on.
I heard the sound of his breath, hissing and gurgling out of him, as the point of the bolt was driven into his chest. And then... nothing. I knew he was dead. I never meant it to happen. I still don't know why he came back.
Perhaps I can tell you. A little earlier, when Philip was talking to Laura at the Traitor's Gate, he remembered something. He suddenly remembered his uncle's monthly visit to inspect Tavistock Court. The old boy would arrive at the flat, let himself in, and no doubt he'd find his stolen headgear. If he searched long enough, he might even have found the manuscript. Philip had to get back there as fast as possible to head him off. He told Laura to wait for him. Do you know, you can get from the tower to Holborn on the Underground in 15 minutes. Sometimes less.
But the body was found at the Traitor's Gate. Would you mind explaining that, Mr. Dowry?
First, I was too paralyzed with fear to think straight. I killed him. Nobody would believe it was an accident. My only hope was to take his body and dump it somewhere else. And I still had to collect the General's car. So I dashed round to the garage and picked it up. Drove to the yard at the back of the flats, which isn't overlooked, carried Phil out and put him in the back seat, under a rug. I took Sir William's top hat as well. I thought if I put it on his head, everyone would assume the Mad Hatter had killed him.
And the manuscript?
Do you imagine, after what had happened, I still wanted to make blood money out of it? Before I left the flat, I chucked it into the grate and put a match to it.
By a strange coincidence, a little later, someone else followed your example. Yet, but that's neither here nor there.
Anyway, I jumped into the car and drove off. And at the next crossroads, the lights changed to red and I had to brake. And what do you think happened then?
Well, as far as I remember, you met your employer.
Oh, no. General!
Well, this is a godsend. What a stroke of luck. I've been standing on that corner for 10 minutes waiting for a cab. Ah, you can drive me back to the tower.
It was like a nightmare. I tried to think. It was only 2:10. If I could dump Phil's body somewhere without being seen, I'd have a perfect alibi. When we got there, I had to pull up at the bloody tower to let the General out. When he'd gone, I opened the back door, whipped off the rug, and hauled the body out. Then I tipped over the rail and down the steps. It was still very foggy, and there was no one in sight. After that, I parked the car and went indoors, and... well, you know the rest.
Yes. Mr. Dowry, will you do something for me?
Of course.
I want you to go into the hall and sit and wait for a few minutes. Don't speak to anyone until I ask you to come back in, all right?
But...
please, don't argue. Just do as you're told.
Very well. Go ahead. Send for your Black Maria, or whatever it's called. I'll wait.
Now what?
I think I must be getting old. I'm sworn to uphold the law. And yet, no jury would ever believe that boy's testimony.
but I do.
Yeah, so do I. I'd say this case could remain unsolved. What do you think, Hadley?
You know what I think. Are we agreed?
Let me have those notes you've been scribbling. I'll look after them.
Better still, let me throw them into the fire. There you are. Case unsolved.
Case unsolved.
In The Mad Hatter Mystery by John Dixon Carr, Dr. Gideon Fell was played by Donald Sinden. Chief Superintendent Hadley, John Hartley. Sir William Batten, Edward Dewsbury. General Mason, Peter Howell. Robert Dalry, Roger Moss. Julius Arbour, Roger Hammond. Yeoman Warder Parker, John Baddeley. Henry Marsh, Anthony Jackson. Laura Batten, Sabina Franklin. Lester Batten, Don McCorkindale. Sheila Batten, Priyanga Elan. The Mad Hatter Mystery was dramatized for radio by Peter Ling and directed by Enid Williams.